doing business as Square Liquors. At 9 p.m., we will review five boards and committees due to sunset and decide how to proceed. And at 9:30, I will lead a discussion with the board on the town manager evaluation process for FY15. So with that, we will go to Selectmen's liaison reports and comments. Start with you, John.
Nothing to report. A quiet summer.
Okay. John?
Actually, I'm going to defer to Kevin, who's chairing two committees that we're working on together. So
that's fine. So I'll go to you.
He's the chair, so.
Yeah, happy to report. John Holland and I, members of the VASC, which is the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee to this board, which handles all the appointments for the for all the expiring and vacant positions that we have, volunteers, boards, and committees here in town. We actually had a really good night. We kind of had a little bit of a fire by trial night. We fit a lot of folks into to a single night. There were two folks, three people total that weren't able to make it or didn't get there? Three total, correct, that weren't able to get there. So there, when we go through them tonight, I can get into it a little bit further, but there are two positions where we did not fill a vacancy because we felt we wanted to give those people their time to get before us and get a proper interview before we just decided to give it to somebody else, especially seeing how we were the ones that said we're going to do it on just this one night and try to get it all done. So we're going to be deferring that into early July to try to get those folks in for an interview before we fill those vacancies. But we do have some really good volunteers, which is great to see, that stepped up in a couple of key roles that you know, we are recommending to the board tonight to put them on as members. So it was good. We had a good night.
Good. Do we still have some unfilled vacancies? I don't know if you have a summary of
what's there. Yes, we do still have some unfilled vacancies. Somebody for every vacancy that we had on every board this past go around. So we definitely have some unfilled vacancies. I forget off the top of my head, was it Conservation Commission, one of those?
Yeah.
I know we're filling a vacancy on there with a really good candidate, but I think there were some other vacancies that could have been also filled in that on that role.
Okay. Is there a way to get the word out, Bob, that we still have some?
Yeah, we have it up on the website, and after you're finished tonight, we'll update what's still open on the website.
Yep, we can always fill after July 1st.
Okay, we'll story out so it's a little clearer.
Great.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I know it wasn't a VASC issue, but I know a number of folks, or I've talked to a number of folks who sent in resumes for the building committee. Do we have any update on that?
Four, last I knew.
We have four.
More for four.
Trickling in.
Okay. So, does it make any sense to sort of interview those folks first, or no?
I'm not sure. I mean, you can't form the committee with them, so.
Okay. I mean, I'd like to sort of include that as another.
You know, we'll put that out when we put the vacancies out to remind people that they really should be.
How is the coverage of the different, you know, skill sets as laid out in the bylaw?
It needs to be more diverse.
Yeah, that's what I'm concerned about. Yeah. So I think it's important we pull a few more in. I don't think they have a, you know, like have to get it done tomorrow kind of schedule.
No, but
I want to proceed as soon as we get
the
critical mass.
Yeah, as soon as we can, publicize it.
Yeah.
You know, you can't sort of force it, but we'll try to publicize it as best
as soon,
we can.
As soon as feasible. We'll be,
summer is sometimes a little trouble.
And in our travels, it might not be a bad idea if you think somebody's qualified to have them throw something in.
Hand out your business card.
More than five.
Yes, Bob, yes.
Just to update on the VASC and the vote you'll be taking. We did decide to proceed and recommend associate members. Those have not yet been approved by the Attorney General. There's no reason you can't, in a motion, make the motion effective July 1st, but technically they can't serve until the AG says so. That could be any day. That could be in the summer.
Technically, they couldn't vote as a full member?
They can't. They don't exist as associate members until the AG says so.
Okay.
So you are allowed to say July 1st, but the real effective date is when the AG says so. So not only can't they vote, they really aren't associate members until they're allowed to be, just to clear that up. pre-associated. I'm a little surprised that it hasn't come down yet, and it may still come down before June 30th.
So they're technically observers?
Yes, they're just the public.
And in regards to that as well, too, we also, one of the candidates, I think it was the candidate for the Conservation Commission, we've been asked to make that person, if this board so puts them on, make that person retroactive as tonight. They have Conservation
okay.
Commission has a meeting tomorrow night. They don't want to wait till June 1st to have this new person.
Are they in a position to be sworn in?
I think as there is an opening, yeah. That's...
Correct.
So it's not like we have to wait for somebody's term to expire.
Right.
So I think that there is an opening and we could do that.
They need to be sworn in.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So they need to stop in tomorrow
okay.
if we vote in such a way tonight.
Is that on the list?
They can stop into the town clerk
yeah,
tomorrow, right?
On page 3, it's listed on the top on parentheses.
Okay. Got it. Yep. Excellent. Okay.
The other report I have is in regards to the firearm ad hoc committee that this
mm-hmm.
board formed. So we met, I think, for our third meeting in total, just last night. And what we had basically charged town council with at our previous meeting was to go out and show us some revisions that he would see, would like to see, if the firearm, our current firearm bylaw 8.9.1 was to be rewritten. He had mentioned to us in a couple of different, or I should say in one meeting a couple of different times that, you know, if you're thinking about making additions or subtractions to what we currently have, what you really should be thinking about is just redo the whole thing. Just scrap what you have, rewrite it. I won't put words in his mouth. I'll let him speak a little bit more about why when at the appropriate time for him, but he didn't like the way a lot of it was phrased and set up. He thought it could be a lot more simple. He thought it certainly could be a little bit stronger with the way, just from a language standpoint. And I think with more legalese than anything else
mm-hmm.
was his,
And he's actually been saying that now for a couple of meetings that he really thinks.
I think he was even saying that all the way back to when this whole thing first came up.
He was saying that in town meeting.
Yeah.
That it was,
yeah,
his opinion
exactly.
was poorly written.
Yeah.
And it may have led to, you know, some of the challenging discussion that went on actually in town meetings.
Right.
So this has been a really good group. You have folks on, you know, on both sides of the aisle. No one, I wouldn't say, really has an agenda per se in this group. I think that was one of the reasons that we thought it was going to be a really good group. And what came out of it last night was the decision to run with one of the options that town council had come up with. And we had asked them to add on to it a little bit, so kind of tweak it a little bit. There was a section in it as well that dealt with definitions that needed to be tweaked a little bit. I was late to that meeting, so the vice chair, Bryn Burkhart, opened the meeting, and they discussed it at that point. So I'm interested to see the revisions that they've made to that as well. I didn't want to interrupt the meeting to go backwards at that point. But at our next meeting, we've set up two additional ones. We haven't already set for July. We set two additional
mm-hmm.
ones just in case we need it.
Mm-hmm.
I think our pace is still to plan to be back before this board.
Okay.
With plenty of time to make a decision if we need to put something forward to another town meeting.
So that looks like a likelihood at this point?
Yeah.
Okay.
It does.
Very good. Okay, Barry?
I attended last week the Economic Development Committee meeting. I got there late, and they were in the midst of distributing, making some decisions in terms of a couple of different applicants for helping with signage. Folks who had applied for that and I think had voted to, I forget exactly who the businesses were. I think one of them may have been the new pet cycling shop that's sort of behind where the Atlantic used to be.
Where Corner Closet was before.
Where Corner Closet, yeah.
Oh,
and
really?
Yep.
It's a, I think a, not a bicycle shop, but more of like a workout.
It's a spinning facility.
Spinning,
oh,
pedaling.
Okay.
I think it's called pedal something.
I think that's right. I think it is a spinning facility.
Yeah. And then there was another one, too, that they had voted to give some funds out. So they were actively working on that. And when I left that meeting, I just sort of popped my head into the Fall Fair Committee. They were in full throes. Apparently they put out the availability of the boots, and they are coming. So they're probably gonna, it's probably gonna be another sold out event. And lastly, like I think most of us actually might have been there. It was sort of right after our last meeting, but I attended the MOPC workshop on the economic development. They had come back with a few more things for us to look at in terms of the four different priority development sites. A couple of them were really interesting, I thought, and I'm looking forward to September when they come back after getting some of the feedback on some other recommendations. So I was particularly intrigued with the proposal that they had for the RMLD, sort of behind that. I thought that was I thought that was interesting. It needs a little bit of work, but I thought that that I think that's the thing that generated the most discussion.
Okay.
So,
I, just out of curiosity, I wasn't able to attend that meeting. Did they finally start to show us more?
Yes.
Commercial space?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. It wasn't all geared at residential.
Yeah. No, they got
not that I'm nice against that, but yeah. It seemed their focus seemed to be on strictly residential.
I mean, there was some
like a little different mix.
Yeah, there was some especially around the RML, you know, sort of the site behind RMLD, like a mixed use development. Now, how does it work? How the traffic? I mean, it's conceptual, but it was interesting, and I think certainly a conversation starter. So yeah, they get the message. It wasn't as well attended as the first one was, but there were a lot of people there.
As a matter of fact, I don't know how you'd feel about this, Barry, but I suggested to them that the venue itself really didn't lend itself. There was enough people there that it was a little chaotic, and you know, I think that we need to have go into the field house or some place where we
or even one of the elementary school cafeterias.
Yes,
yeah,
so you know,
yeah, yeah, I mean, you couldn't hear a lot of the comment. Yeah. And that was just, and there were four different sessions going on at the same time, and
it was good, but it was tough to.
It was tough to move. And just the way the room was configured, it was hard to go from, point A to point C if you were interested in going to that one. So I think they got the. I think someone had brought it. Bob, you might have been brought it up to move the facility, get maybe either one of the cafeterias at the schools or maybe even the field house. But it was well attended, and I think that usually on things like this, the first one is like a lot of people and then it kind of dies. Here it didn't.
No.
And I think that's a tribute to the fact that people are really interested in this and understand the importance of getting it right. So that was exciting. I'm looking forward to what they come up with in September.
At that meeting, of all the meetings I've been to in the last 10 years, interestingly, that was the one where the most new people to meetings and to Reading came and told me. This is my first public meeting. I'm new to Reading within the last year or 2 years. I think it's absolutely phenomenal that you're asking our opinions. So it was really interesting that kind of person is coming up to the meetings. They're not the traditional people we see. A lot
of new faces.
Oh, that's great.
You know, to stay on this theme, there was a lunch and learn at the senior center a week later, and I know the lunch is a draw, but the place was packed, and it was very interesting. Jesse Wilson was trying to give a condensed 15-minute summary, and it couldn't be at 15 minutes. I mean, it went on probably 35 or 40 minutes. There's a lot of interest in these discussions. Got to remind people that it's conceptual, that there's not something moving, down the road. But there's a lot. It seems to me, to Bob's point, we had a lot of new faces for nighttime, which is great. And in the middle of the day, the seniors turned out in force with lots of great questions.
What were their comments? What were their thoughts?
They were kind of all over the place.
Obviously, they don't really care about schools or things like that. They're more probably.
No, but I will tell you something that was of great interest to them. That there might be housing arrangements that. A lot of seniors have a great interest in staying in Reading, but maybe not in their house. And there was a lot of questions about that.
Interesting.
There was concerns about You know, we don't have enough places to park now when we go places. I mean, there was a lot of, I thought it was a good discussion. It was kind of, it was really all over the board, but it was pointed more in the direction of the demographic group that was
yep.
present, you know, which is logical.
Good.
I think that's why I think if we create the next one of these meetings in a venue that is more user friendly from the standpoint of parking, roaming around, kind of all of it, I think that it would we'd be surprised at the crowd that would show up.
Very good.
September, is that when?
Yes.
September 23rd, I think, was the day.
23rd.
Yeah. Any idea why this one drew such a different demographic? We do something different?
It was advertising.
Word of...
It was
advertised on social media?
Social media, showed up on social media.
It was a lot on social media. And there was a lot of encouragement from Rotary encouraged it. Chamber of Commerce encouraged it. I mean, so kind of, you know, around the horn, there was a lot of encouragement to attend and hear what was being thought about. So, and I think we need to, it gets back to this, you know, public-private partnership thing. The more we can enfranchise those organizations that have an active interest in what happens in the town, the better off all of us will be, because it'll
sure.
bring more people to the discussion.
Yep.
Okay. All set? Yeah, my only report was attending the same meeting, and I will echo the comments of my colleagues. It was good and very well received. At this point, we have time for public comment for any item not on the agenda. Mr. Brown.
I came down for all the staffs of the voting committee, too. And I think it's 5 permanent members and 2 temporary members, and there's 2 temporary members all willing to serve on the thing for the cemetery building. The other thing, Dan, you and I talked at the Friends and Family Day, I believe, on
yep.
possibly outsourcing the cemetery. I believe under Chapter 114, the trustees hire the people to do the cemetery work under your approval. So you'd have to persuade 6 people to
yep.
outsource it, which I don't think will happen.
Fair point.
And I've got the chapter here if you want.
Bill, you are the unquestionable authority on that. Any other public comment? Okay, we'll move to the town manager's report.
A couple quick things that's not in writing. Dan had asked me a week or two ago to inquire about the state elections next spring, and whether the local election should be moved. And the formal answer is there has been no decision yet made on the state primary. The likely answer is there's a reasonable probability it will be moved to February.
February? Okay. I thought they were trying to That doesn't sound right. I thought the decision was between March 1st and combining them in June. There have been bills put out.
I heard last week of February, but...
How many towns would that really
forced
to have?
Yeah.
It doesn't mean
two
you
separate elections.
Doesn't mean you have to have.
No, I know it doesn't, but you know,
the local election is somewhere in the first week of April.
Right.
Our advice as a rule of thumb is if you want to move it up 4 or 5 weeks, that's okay. If it's more than 4 or 5 weeks, it's
yeah.
not okay.
Yeah.
And the reason it's important is because everything gets moved up, let's say, 4 weeks.
Right.
So pulling papers, going out and getting
mm-hmm.
signatures would, you know, bump
you have
into
to pull
the
papers during
fall.
Christmas vacation.
Yeah,
yeah.
It'd be November,
something like that.
Christmas. So, you know, the town clerk's ready and able to do whatever you folks decide, but we will want to, as soon as there's a decision we made, we'll want to advertise that to as many people as possible.
What did you hear February?
February.
I just heard it from someone that works for the state, but it's not
okay.
official. It's being discussed.
Especially after this February, we just have really.
Yeah, you would think.
Some wise thinking there.
Electronic voting.
I mean, I've seen the Massachusetts primary be in early March.
Yes.
On a presidential.
Last time it was.
Yeah.
2008, I think it was February.
And it was maybe a couple of weeks after New Hampshire, but
right.
yeah.
I didn't think that it was.
Well,
that's really early.
Really.
Your first year important. The other thing I wanted to mention is Dan and I had lunch with town council last Friday, and I just wanted to emphasize that it's a great hire you made. You know, from all perspectives, he's covering all our bases very effectively. They've been very busy. They're a good law firm, and they tell us we're a good client, so it's a good result.
Yeah.
I just wanted to tell you that.
Sure.
Matt Cornelis, the Administrative Services Director. I told him I wouldn't bug him for at least a month, so we finally met today. And he would like to sit down with each and every one of you as you are available and just chat. And I can join you if you want or not, it doesn't really matter. He already handed me several pages of the work he's been doing. And you'll be very happy at the way he's approaching communication philosophically. He's very engaged, he's very thoughtful. He's, for instance, the Friends and Family Day, he was taking pictures and Twittering them out right away.
Cool.
Yeah.
So he's about 50 years ahead of me in technology. So I think that'll be helpful. You know, the one thing you don't want to do in technology is start something and not keep it up if it's something the residents like. So
yeah,
we'll have a discussion at your July meeting on our technology. We're going to probably give you 45 minutes, soup to nuts, and give you some things to think about as to what paths you want to go down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not to interrupt, Bob. Is that no. when's CCLIC Fix going to be coming up? Is that before
we have
then?
To decide that by December.
Okay.
So probably sometime around September we should know, so that's plenty of time.
All right.
We all like it. I mean, it can be used more broadly than we are. I assume we like it. The other thing I just wanted to throw out there, and I don't have a solution yet, but I've heard a lot of discussion in the community about bun raddies.
But what?
And the bun raddies and their hours with children or no children. I'll sit down with them next week. They have every right to do whatever hours they want for children. They do need to follow the Selectmen's policy and have a full menu available while they're serving alcohol. So I'll just sit down and remind them of that. If they want to have children, they don't want to have children, that's their own choice. But they can't become a bar. They can't not have full food service. And that's what early reports on social media are, that they're not having full food service after 7 o'clock on weeknights.
So it's actually just coming off of their website.
Yeah.
Not just social media. Is.
Yeah. So, you know, we've checked your policy. We know your policy. They do too. We'll just remind them. You can invite whoever you want or, discriminate as long as the law allows you to, and in this case it would. But you have to serve food. It has to be available.
Was there something specific about not having children there?
They have announced a policy of no children after 7 o'clock at night on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or after 9 p.m. on the other nights. No children will be allowed in the restaurant.
That doesn't fly in the face of any discrimination?
No, because children are a protected class, interestingly. So,
but until they can vote.
If they're saying no children, and they're supposed to have a full menu, and a child comes in, they're not going to be able to say.
They have asked the people to leave.
How have they defined the child?
That I don't exactly know. We're going to have a new sting by the police,
we
decided.
Yeah.
Send in a 2-year-old.
I'd like to. I mean,
so we'll have a chat. As long as they're following your policy.
Huh. Yeah, I mean, we've waited long enough for them to open, and I think we want them to be good neighbors. And so.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure the community understood that.
You know,
we didn't expect this. The selectmen didn't anticipate this.
Right.
Yeah. Is this how they behave in their other?
I think in Boston, maybe. Boston has lots of different rules, though. There's bars in Boston. There's not supposed to be bars in Reading.
No.
So, yeah, this is not an unheard-of thing, conceptually.
Yeah, go ahead, Kevin.
I had heard this last night, actually, on social media, of course.
Yeah.
And, someone, a friend of mine, tagged me on their post so I could see it. Assuming that's part of why you may have heard about it from that conversation I had last night as well, probably. My biggest fear is, obviously I think you're going to have plenty of uproar over, their decision to do this. We really do like to see businesses thrive here in town.
Yeah.
And one of the biggest fears I have is it took them so long to get that up and running that they're going to be shutting the doors in a year if they go about this kind of line of thinking. So, if you're going to have that conversation, you may want to say, geez, you may want to rethink it. At least get yourself up and running.
Well, their customer base will drive that.
Exactly.
That's kind of where I'm going with it. I think you're going to get a lot of people that have already said, okay, I'm not going there then. And, you hate to see a business that took so long to come to town that could be a really great business get off on that kind of start.
All I'll say is, I agree with you, but the residents in town that think somehow the town controls how many bagel stores, how many nail salons. You know, the market decides.
Exactly.
We don't say, I'm sorry, you know, other than liquor stores.
We have explained licenses. That to a couple of folks.
Yeah. You know, the selectmen don't decide who's coming into town. The businesses decide, and likewise, businesses decide how to run themselves. We give them all advice they want, but ultimately, at the end of the day, as long as they're following the rules, they do whatever they want. So, you know, we do try to give advice to restaurants or other businesses, but it's cautious because we're not running their business.
Right, right.
I mean, if our policy is not being followed, what's the process and what's our recourse?
I'm visiting them with a couple people next week, so we'll figure that out.
Okay.
Just remind them.
Bob, there were a couple other issues I'd ask you to look into. The signal on Bay State Road in Salem, Oakland Road.
If you haven't seen, there's construction down there.
I saw the holes.
That's a good sign.
Yep.
And what was the other
Oakland
one?
Oakland Road, the disposition of that property. Where are we with the Paper Street resolution?
I'd have to get back to you. The last I heard from town council is he didn't have all the paperwork done from land court.
Okay. How imminent is this going to be?
I'll ask him for your next meeting.
Because this is starting to drag.
Yeah.
Maybe a future agenda, we could talk about second water meters and pros and cons, because we're getting some inquiries. I am, anyway.
Yeah, I am as well.
Yeah.
It's a hot topic.
Okay.
Because the weather gets higher.
The wells are being drilled everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, well, knows.
Which is very
doing
interesting.
Very well.
Yeah, I think the board discussed it within the last 2 years. I can't remember exactly when and who.
I don't think while I was on it.
More than a year ago.
More than 2 years ago.
More than two.
Okay.
Probably three.
Yeah, I don't recall being on the board.
I don't know if the facts on the grounds have changed in terms of how we're billed and whether that affects anything. Yeah.
The bottom line for when the board last discussed it was simplicity, equity. We did a survey. We showed what other communities do.
Yeah.
It's a mix. There's no solution there. One of the philosophical questions is we bill sewer based on water usage.
Yeah.
If you had a second water meter, clearly you should not bill sewerage on that.
Right.
So you'd have to come up with a different algorithm. And a prior board decided people that have a second water meter and could afford it should also pay the sewer charge.
So
why separate it? In other words, if you're going to have an irrigation system, which normally this is what it's for.
Yeah, but isn't the whole point that water's going right back into the ground? And so the idea of sewer...
It is, except that we're not billed it.
But their
the fact that it goes
was,
in the ground doesn't help our sewer bill.
We're going to bill the amount of sewerage we need to cover.
Right.
We're going to just allocate it however
right.
it is.
It's so just going
to
be...
The board's feeling was if you can afford to have a irrigation system, you can afford to take
so
your
maybe,
share.
Well, this comes back to, you know, a topic similar to one we talked about not too long ago about billing gross and net. I mean, the sewer bill is the sewer bill. And that's going to be allocated among the people using water, regardless of what
right.
meter they're on, I think. I think I've got this, I think I understand this correctly. So if what we find is that the water usage falls off because there's water, you know, the water usage is going, you know, directly into landscaping, the net effect is the sewer rate is going to go up.
Yep.
I mean, you know, because the sewer cost is the sewer cost,
correct.
And that's currently being allocated as people are using water across the board. If you use less water, it's going to continue to be allocated, and what's going to happen...
And water's going to go up, too, because we have to bill the water more, because, you know...
And the music goes round and round.
Yeah, right.
The water doesn't want to sell.
As I said when we had this discussion around the gross and net, I think people just want to know what it is that they're paying
yeah.
for and why they have to pay for it and understand.
We'll discuss it again.
Good test,
you know, the most transparency possible, I think, is the
okay.
always the wisest choice. So.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all I have. Thanks.
All right, let's move on to the sale bond anticipation notes so we can borrow some money. Bob, you want to walk us through this and then we'll...
Yeah,
do a portion of the motion, I think.
Yeah, you don't obviously have to
yes.
read that whole motion. We'll be here all night. But the treasurer borrowed for 1 year for projects that were needing money in this fiscal year. And state law is such, actually municipal finance is such, that we can borrow internally from ourselves, but not over a fiscal year.
Right.
So we have been borrowing, and I'll ask you next July to approve an internal borrowing for next year. but for this year, you know, we're putting the two school projects, the $500,000 retaining wall and the million odd modular classrooms, as well as a tiny piece of water into this one-year bond. I'm sorry, ban. A year from now, we'll take all that and permanently finance it, and we'll add in the remainder of the library project, which should be certainly known by June, and anything else that comes along. So there'll probably be other water main work. If the Birch Meadow Phase 2 is ready, we'll have that as well, and anything else that may happen. And just now this isn't a bad time to mention it, just to mention it to you, and I'll mention it to FinCom tomorrow night. We and the facilities department have run into capital costs that are exceeding our budgets. I'll give you one example. The Killam field work, $200,000 was put in the budget. We put it out for bid early in the spring. It came in at $390,000 was the best bid. And so we got rid of the infield grading, figuring that would easily drive it under $200,000. We had only one bidder respond, and it's over $200,000. We can't do the project this year. So just be aware that that's a common theme. Our road projects, facilities is running to it. There's a lot of stuff going on, and again, people aren't bidding on things.
Yeah.
It's just not a very competitive.
They're not hungry, in other words, is work out.
They want bigger. They want a bigger project, or they don't want to.
Yeah, I think they want bigger projects, and I don't think there's a capacity for a lot more work. There's, you know, it was a tough winter, so for paving, everyone is trying to pave.
Right.
So I just wanted you to be aware that we're going to be turning back money at the end of the year we wouldn't normally have. We'd have been doing projects, and we'll have to go back to November town meeting or some future town meeting and go again and say, you know, what we want to do.
Does it make sense then to bundle some of these projects? So, you know, you're going to go out on the Killam field, but, you know, next year you're going to, you know, you're going to be doing, I'm making this up, the Barrows
yeah.
field. Does it make sense to kind of, let's do all the like things together so that it becomes a big project and then you get more bidders?
That. We certainly do that with construction, with road construction. Killam was kind of unique. What we were doing in the field, we're not imagining to do anywhere else. But what I talked about with them is, hey, can DPW do this work? And the answer is, yeah, a lot of it. But if, with enough planning and overtime, they could do it. They have most of the equipment to do it. They have most of the expertise. They would have to subcontract part of it. Based on the bids we saw, we could probably save $200,000.
Yeah.
That's things we're going to need to start thinking about.
Right.
But you don't suddenly decide to do that. You've got to plan that a couple of years or a year at least.
Yeah, it sounds like that's it. If we're going to have to not do the project, like,
yeah.
you know, I like that idea a lot, Barry, actually.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if we can do it internally, but it requires a year's worth of planning, and it cuts the cost in half,
yeah.
I think we have to, you know.
Yeah.
And it sounds like we're not going to be able to do it anyway because,
right.
you know, circumstances being what they are. It seems like what the thing was at Killam, as I recall having attended the, or looking at that with the recreation committee, I thought they were filling in that outfield to make it come to grade with the infield. Because
right
now, it, you know, it gets out and it drops off into kind of never,
right.
never land back there. And I think the
and
thought
a lot
was,
of drainage work also.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if you leveled it, you could actually, at the age that the kids are using that field, besides what it's being used for at the school, you could actually put two or three games
right.
at one time. You know, optimize, you know, the usage of the field, whether it's soccer or baseball or whatever it is. You know.
Good job.
Bob, any other similar contracts like the Killam field that have come in substantially above?
Sewer station work, we had bundled two of them together, like Barry suggested,
two.
Instead of doing one in a year and then another one, we bundled two together. Order of magnitude was way off. I don't remember exactly, but we had 700,000, it came in at 1,000,003 or something like that. It's just way off. So, you know, that's going to take some thinking. And again, some of it is just inflation and some of it is it's a lousy market. So you don't know. You put it out again in a year or next winter, maybe the 700,000 comes in at 850 instead of 1,000,002 or 1,003. You know, and we just kind of go with our best guess. Some of the stuff we haven't done in years. We haven't priced things in years. So it's really hard to know. And the engineers are always learning. You know, okay.
Yep.
And actually what we discussed today was this summer we're going to take a look at the whole capital plan and reprice it based on our experience. It's, if it's not accurate, we've got to fix it. So it is, it's an issue that we've not seen before for many years that we're not able to accomplish. And occasionally you run into a project, but we're not able to accomplish a handful. I know the facilities department had a $50,000 generator for this building. the last estimate I got was 150. So there was some additional work needed. So order of magnitude, this isn't, you know, the field, the recreation field today came in only like 20,000 over, so it's only 10%. Was there a way to do it? I said, that's when people go to prison. You know, oh sure, recreation funds could pay for it, or maybe we get a donation. I said, you know, look, you probably could. I said, and if it's legal, maybe we could look into it, but let's just try not to get too creative here. That's when you run into trouble. You put it out to bid, you didn't have enough money, move on.
And we are borrowing this at the exorbitant rate of 0.75%?
Actually at 0.46%.
0.46.
That's a coupon, is 0.75.
Okay.
Hey, what's the difference between the coupon rate and the net interest? So,
they,
so if
they
I
pay
buy
us
it,
a premium.
If I buy it, I'm getting 0.75.
If
I buy the
bond. If you're the retail customer, you're going to get 0.46 because you've given me $1.10 and I'm going to give you a dollar back in a year or whatever the numbers are. And I'm going to be paying you
the higher coupon rate,
but I'm going to be keeping some principal in my pocket. So the net interest is 0.46 on this one, or 0.43, I don't remember. I think it's 0.46.
Yeah,
it's almost free.
Okay, could we have a motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the sale of a 0.75% general obligation bond anticipation note of the town dated June 29, 2015, payable June 29, 2016, to Century Bank and Trust Company at par plus a premium of $6,859. Further voted that in connection with the marketing and sale.
Mr. Berman moves that we suspend the further reading of this motion. You moved a finger.
Saved. I winked.
Okay. Is that seconded?
Second.
All in favor? Okay. That's a suspending the reading of the rest. Now, all those in favor of the main motion, please raise your hand. 5-0, the motion carries.
Thank you. We will have many things for you to sign
tonight. Okay. 5B, approve regional health agreement with Melrose. Want to walk us through this, Bob?
Sure. You got in your packet a scaled back version, if you will, of a regionalized agreement. We are continuing the agreement with Melrose for one senior health inspector. We're sharing her 80-20. We're getting the 20. The aldermen met in Melrose on Monday night and substantially agreed, although they've not given the final vote. I think they have what I would call a first reading and a second reading. I expect they will approve this in early July. So as it was written and presented to you was the form that they approved at their first reading. Again, we're sharing an employee for one year. We're using 20% of her time. Melrose is retaining 80%. The primary function, John Halsey knows all this, but to step back, we're in the process. We've hired a half-time public health nurse who's excellent, and we are in the process of hiring a full-time health agent for the Board of Health. And as you'll see shortly, we had two volunteers for the Board of Health that are great. So we'll have a really strong Board of Health as well. This part-time position from Melrose will, at the very least, tide over for one year, a new person coming in and learning what to do. This person specifically is tasked with restaurant plant inspection. And she's been doing that for us for a couple of years under the old agreement. And she's been doing a good job.
Very good.
Dan,
yeah. Yes, sir. Question?
Barry.
Bob, when I read through the contract, it didn't stipulate, unless I missed it, sort of how the time gets allocated. It doesn't say the 80-20 in here.
That's correct.
Is there?
There is an Appendix A, and if you looked, they didn't present.
Those were just my questions.
It was blank. Behind Appendix A was last year's Appendix A, so I gave you that as an example.
Oh, you did?
There's an Excel right there, that next page.
Oh, okay.
So that's Appendix A from the year before. And if you look at that carefully enough and you see the name Jen, you'll see the spread for Reading over in the far is 20%. Mm-hmm. So there is an appendix that gets into the financial details that I've seen a draft of. But since they haven't approved it, I can't ask you to approve that part yet.
And so it's a two-step process, then we need to wait?
You just need to approve the agreement, and it has an Appendix A, and that's fine. But I can't technically show you Appendix A until Melrose has approved it.
Until they agree to it. Yep.
Yeah.
Got it.
How about the verbiage in the contract? Can they take another hack at it after we approve it?
If they do, I'll need to come back to you. If they change anything, I'll need to come back. I don't anticipate any. I was told not to by their council today.
Sir, do you want, are you looking for a vote tonight?
I think you should vote tonight. That would allow us to get her services on July 1st, otherwise it expires.
Yeah, let's.
And if I need to come back and ask you to revise it on July 21st, I will.
Very good. May we have a motion?
Now, move the Board of Selectmen approve the intermunicipal agreement between the City of Melrose and the Town of Reading for shared public health services with the incumbent Melrose Senior Health Inspector.
Is that seconded?
Okay.
Okay.
I did have a couple other questions.
Sure.
The contract also didn't stipulate sort of, you know, if what our recourse is if we don't think we're getting our 20, if we're only getting 10%. And it doesn't really kind of stipulate sort of how disputes are resolved and how that's done. So I don't know if that's left out intentionally.
The mayor and the town manager punch each other.
Okay. Other than abrogating the agreement, 180 days notice.
You know, what we've discussed with the regional groups, we meet monthly, and a lot of it's on trust.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have everything legislated and documented be that thick. So I agree that some of these agreements are a little thin. They're done that way on purpose. You know, lawyers look at them from both sides, and they both say, you know, you really ought to have more. And we say, no, we don't want more. So it's really a matter of trust between the two communities and the two leaders. And anytime we've had discussions and had disputes, so-called, we talk them through. It's okay. But to be clear, in this example, this is a Melrose employee,
right,
fully. Under their HR, the whole nine yards, they're
right,
their employee. I have no say over that. Sometimes it's our employee for the regional housing person.
We do have a say to a degree, I think, in this, though, over some giant jump in services that we have to pay out, though, as a result of their collective bargaining that might be happening on their end. Correct?
Yeah. If they have a collective bargaining episode, I don't honestly remember if this is a union person. I think it may be. If they have some kind of adjustment in the middle of the year,
right,
hard luck.
Yeah, that's
we're paying half or whatever, 20% in this case.
Okay.
So I know about that, and they give me their best estimate on costs, usually 6 months in advance, and they've always been good, so I'm okay. But yeah, you're never going to find a regional agreement that's going to be perfect in that sense, because no two communities are exactly the same.
The interesting thing is this particular agreement with Melrose, at least my experience over the last year of being involved as liaison to the Board of Health, has actually worked quite smoothly in spite of the fact that there were some speed bumps along the way, and Bob and the mayor were able to walk through those things, and then human resources together. And so I think the nature of these, although they don't seem extremely buttoned up, is probably works best the way that we've been doing it. I think this is very similar to the agreement we had previously,
if it's identical other than the people involved.
Yeah.
And I'll add to that that it is very different than corporations. We have mutual aid that's not even written down between communities. So,
right. Do we have anybody on our staff performing these tasks now?
We have people that could perform them. So if this went away, we could handle it. But with a new person, we thought it was best to just continue this at least for a year. And if Melrose is willing, we'll talk about it.
It's a relatively inexpensive,
yes,
not fixed, but you know, it's a backstop for a lot of new people in that department.
Yeah,
as we
and new Board of Health members, absolutely.
We only actually have one remaining Board of Health member who happens to be the chair and very experienced.
Yep,
we have two, you know, who are retiring, and you know we've got new staff coming in. So I think just my opinion, having gone to most of their meetings actually over the course of the last year. I think keeping this backstop in place is probably probably very prudent.
And one of the changes we made was there was a part-time health inspector that Melrose had as an employee that was fully dedicated to Reading. So as of July 1st, we're hiring that person as our employee through this arrangement. So he will no longer be under the regional. He is through June 30th. He's just our employee part-time as of July 1st.
And this role is essentially for the restaurants, making sure that they're complying and
inspecting. Yeah.
No, it looked a little, having read contracts all day, it seemed a little.
So you good? Any more questions?
I'm fine.
Okay.
I'm
fine. Any other questions? So let's proceed to the vote. All in favor of the motion for the intermunicipal agreement with Melrose? Vote is 5-0, the motion carries. Okay, Secretary, read the hearing notice for the FY16 non-union classification and compensation plans here.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 23rd, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on approval of the fiscal year 16 non-union compensation and classification plans. Copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on June 23rd, 2015 to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us.
Okay, we'll have a presentation from Bob followed by questions from the board, and then I'll open it up for general comment. Bob?
Okay, thank you. First, I'll go over the classification and then the compensation. Behind me is the classification plan. There are no proposed grade changes, if you will, for a given position, but there's a lot of renaming and some reshuffling. I'll go over them from the top of the screen to the bottom. There's an Arcasic position in grade D, covered by a federal grant that is going to change its name, as you can see from, I left in the old one, so you can see Community Outreach Program Coordinator to Youth Coordinator, so that's just a name change. In the next grade, grade E, there's a social worker position that's been in the chart for a while. We had 1.5 FTEs working as social worker. One of them was an Arcasa employee, another worked at Town Hall. I don't know if you remember, but as part of the budget, the half-time social worker position was eliminated and consolidated with the nurse advocate. Mm-hmm. And the Arcasa person would prefer actually to be called this title, Arcasa Outreach Coordinator. So again, she's already at this grade. She'll continue to stay at this grade. Working down the chart in grade I, there's two different things going. Actually, there's a couple things going on. This position here, DPW Water Distribution Supervisor, was a retirement from February, so the position was discontinued. I'll get back to those asterisks in a minute. Our CASA director, that's Erica, that's a title change. It was called something more complicated in the past. Health agent is the position we just talked about. Instead of health administrator, the Board of Health preferred to be called health agent. There's three other positions on this line with asterisks, and there's one down below, town engineer. Those four employees are all currently collective bargaining to join a union, so I can't really say much more other than they will no longer be on the non-union compensation plan. Grade J is a title change, treasurer collector, now that the charter has been done. She's got a very long title, treasurer collector and assistant finance director.
I see that business going.
Yeah.
Yeah. She'd have the same size box but fewer cards.
Takes two.
Grade K, we have yet to hire, but we will advertise in July for the assistant fire chief. That used to be called fire executive officer, and I didn't like the way that sounded at all. Grade L was town accountant. Now it's town accountant finance director. Again, we're waiting for the charter to be finished. So if you will, these changes, in my estimation, are largely cosmetic. There's certainly nothing financial on that page.
Could have called them the fire XO. That would have worked.
Yeah. Well, we can't use other terms because of union implications. This is a non-union position. The assistant fire chief is fine.
All right. Questions from the board?
Any questions on this chart?
No.
Okay, any questions from the public on the chart? Okay. Go ahead, Mayor.
So essentially these are the same classes that we've been using.
Correct.
Now, was this part of the pay and grade study and just kind of, I'm curious, I mean.
I'll give you some background. I was going to wait for the next one. Let me give you a little background. This is the same format we had previous to the pay and class study. The pay and class study recommendations that we got last fall were to, I can't remember exactly, but keep approximately the same amount of grades, maybe reduced by one or two. But to change the distance between the grades, right now it's 10%, it's very linear. Keep 12 steps, 2% a step, which we have, which you don't actually see here, but to rearrange the grades. And
Just 13.
Just, is it? That's grades, right?
Grades.
Steps you wouldn't see.
Okay.
There's 12 steps, just so you know, to reach
10%.
Since Matt got here, I basically outsourced the rest of the project to him, saying, you're neutral, you're Switzerland, you don't know anyone here, you figure it out. Anytime you change your paying class format, if you're willing to grandfather people against harm, you're going to spend a lot of money just rearranging the deck chairs, if you will. And we did that once. When the consultant presented his final recommendation, I can't remember the exact number, but I estimated it would have cost us $450,000 to make the change, and there were no intermediate steps possible. It was such a radical change in plans. So I asked him, go back and use this format and give it your best shot as to what you think, and then, absent of that, make your final recommendation on your judgment. So he did that, and we implemented that last January, and his final recommendation remained the plan that I still don't like, that's wacky, that would take $400,000. So I've asked Matt, I said, look this over, figure it out. When I say wacky, you know, I respect his judgment, but he was having what I would view random distances between grades, 6.7%, 3.2%, 14.8%. I don't know where the numbers came from. He did them based on the market, I guess. The amount of turmoil that would cause internally would be significant. The amount of just putting people to the next appropriate place that's no lower than where they were would cost more than the money we had, again.
Right.
So it just didn't make logical sense. So Matt's going to take, I said, I don't want my opinion to count. I want you to do it. Just give me something that's implementable, which gets us into the next part. So that's the background, if you will, of all that. I guess I'm like Pete. I like things nice and neat and orderly. You know, 10% between grades, everyone understands. 2% steps, everyone understands. I'd have to have a real compelling reason to change that, honestly. Maybe we don't have enough grades. Maybe we don't have enough steps. Maybe we have too many. Maybe things are in the wrong place. I'm fine with all of that. But to change the structure would be a big thing.
I mean, my question is not so much the structure, mm-hmm. but in terms of sort of when they did the study, you know, for example, what's included in a grade? So I know we have our 20 or 25 communities that we
right.
sort of like to compare ourselves to demographically. And so, for example, you know, let's just pick one. You know, an appraiser. It's in grade J.
Yep.
In Danvers, would that guy be an I or K? You know, a librarian is an E, you know, but would Lexington have that person an F or G? And
it's not a simple question to answer because there was two parts of the analysis. Maybe there was three. The first part was internal equity, it was called, and it was an internal scoring of the difficulty and skill set needed for each position. So if you look at this list, there's a pretty wide range of skills. It's pretty hard to do. It's very subjective. But nonetheless, the consultant came up with a method and graded positions up to, I think the highest was 11 or 1200, and 400 maybe was the lowest. And so all of these have a numerical score to them.
Mm-hmm.
It is not perfectly true, but it is generally true that they're grouped that way. And the reason it's not perfect is because the other part of this, which has either one or two parts, is a financial analysis. And I'll tell you right now, the town accountant's position, they're not making those anymore. It's very hard to find one. So the market rate of pay and the structural rate of pay of the town accountant is higher than maybe what a numerical score would suggest. Because if you want to hire one, that's what you got to do. And the reason I mention there's two parts is one is the structural pay, which is this is our published range, and that's what we used. We used the median or the midpoint, rather. But then there's also, you know, the structural rate of pay published isn't working anymore, so we're really paying way up there. And we have that data from other communities. So it's somewhat of art. You put all that together, could you argue any one of these positions to somewhere else? I don't know. Some of them. But, you know, I have to say, I looked it over, and what he did made sense, generally. You know, is the pay right? No, and we'll get to that.
Okay.
Okay, anything more on the classification plan? Let's move on to the compensation plan.
I've put two compensation plans in your packet. There's a 1% cost of living increase, and there's a 1.5% cost of living increase, and this would be again for all non-union staff. Just to give you some background, the generally accepted tool around here to measure CPI is called the Boston Brockton Nashua CPI. That's what RMLD uses for their annual payment to us. I'm not sure why, but they picked that out many years ago. Over the last 10 years, that's been running around 1.5% a year with some fairly good volatility. There was a negative 1 year, but 1.5 is about right. I didn't go back 10 years, but I did go back 5 years. We're averaging about 1% to 1.1% of COLA. The 1% was passed by town meeting and clearly affordable. If you recall, we also set aside $55,000 for pay and class funding. If we move to 1.5%, which is what I am requesting, that means that every non-union employee will share in approximately half that money. I say approximately, I think it's a little bit more. So maybe we'll use up $30,000 or $28,000 of that $55,000 mm-hmm. right here, right now. If you approve it, we'll go to November town meeting and we'll adjust all the budgets as needed. And Matt is tasked to spend the rest of that in some way that he determines and recommends, along with, honestly, more importantly, a strategy of how to take care of this long term. And long term, you know, it's a tough area. We basically need to add $100,000 to the budget for 3 years in a row, and that'll come close. But what are other communities doing in the meanwhile? I'll be honest, they seem to pay more than I can understand how they can afford. That's what my observation is for the last 5 or 10 years. So we need to do a better job of doing that also. You know, and I'll take that as my responsibility.
Paying what we can't afford?
Well, I'll have to somehow work magic. Mm-hmm. So we can afford it, and it's more than I would have thought.
Are we seeing kind of a runoff of talent to other towns? I know I've asked this of the superintendent.
Yeah.
Where you sometimes will see a bigger range. I mean, the thing is, I'd like to know, are we keeping the people that we want to keep?
No,
or are we having a harder time keeping them because we're not paying?
Where it's most obvious to any of us that hire is replacing someone who leaves for any reason, whether they retire, they move out of state, or they get another job. To replace a person, no matter where they are in the organization, no matter what they're earning, is very difficult to do at the same rate of pay. And I think universally all of our departments would say that, including the schools. That tells you you're not all that competitive, maybe. Can we strictly say, you know, we've lost 7 people in the last year and 2 of them are because of pay? I can't say that. I don't know. Are we not hiring people because we're not offering the right rate of pay?
That's
something that's difficult to prove, because we don't know who didn't apply for the job that saw it based on the range. It's an art, not a science. John and I talk about this. Our gut feel is, yeah, it's a problem. Is it a crisis? No, it's not a crisis, but it's something that needs to be fixed. You know, you want to have quality employees. You would rather have fewer quality employees than a lot of employees that aren't as high quality. So that's the fairest answer I can give you. So, you know, 1% has been approved and is in the budget, 1.5 is affordable, and that's what I'd ask you to do.
Further questions from the board? Any questions from the folks? Okay.
Close the meeting.
Okay, has been a motion to close the hearing. Is that seconded? All in favor? Closing the hearing. 5-0. And if we have a motion to approve the plans. And the board is agreeable, 1.5.
1.5.
That.
Okay. Do you make a motion for that?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the fiscal year 16 non-union classification plan and the fiscal year 16 non-union compensation plan that includes a 1.5% increase from fiscal year 15.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor? 5-0, the motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. We are now ready for the members' report from RCTV.
Thanks, John.
Awesome. please feel free to introduce yourself and your team. Anybody else will be speaking?
Yes, I'm Kevin Walsh. I am your Selectmen representative on the RCTV board. With me here tonight is Kathy Crook, who is the new president of RCTV. Wave your hand, Kathy. Marcel Dubois, our previous president and board member, current board member. Phil Rushworth, who's the executive director, many of you know him.
Yep.
And Katie Robertson, a new member, and she's been very active in front of the camera. And John Carpenter, pardon me, John, board member as well, and very active member. What we'd like to do, with your permission, Mr. Chairman, is have Kathy join me, because Steve Goldie, the other member, who's from you guys, from the Selectmen camp. So Kathy, why don't you take a chair up here, and we'll give you a briefing.
Okay.
Sit
there. Oh, sure.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, on October of 2013, we gave an update to this board. I know there's a couple new selectmen. We really went through the basics, the who, what, where, when, and why. I think many of you know this stuff, and some of the stuff gets technical, like when television stations were formed and what this makeup is. So what we'd like to do tonight is just, and many of you know it, what we'd like to do tonight is just cover what's been happening, what's in the new developments of RCTV, where we're going. As a reminder, my involvement with Reading TV started in 1998 as a producer. I made productions that RCTV aired. Reading residents can do what I do. They can become a member, they pay $20. They can take a class on how to use the equipment, which is for free. They'll teach you everything. They will then lend you the equipment for free. Then you go out and you film, you come back, and they will teach you how to edit your production, and then you finally ask them to air it and you put it on TV. Mm-hmm. All right, so this is something that we want the people at home to know as well, that anybody, any Reading residents and others can become members and participate in what we call Reading content, content about Reading, things that are happening in Reading. Not just government meetings, but what the band is doing, what the baseball team is doing, what the football teams are doing. Now, as a producer, a creator, I produced about 65 different programs. Years ago, I produced Pop Warner Football when my son was active. And over the last few years, I produced about 7 shows for elder services, things like Living Options in Reading. This stuff is not only on TV, but now we're starting, we'll talk about this at the end, to put a lot of the stuff on YouTube as well, so people can look at it on demand. Now, your time is valuable, so I'd like to hand this over to Kathy, who will introduce herself and talk about some of the developments, some of the stuff we're working on this year.
Yeah, mostly my what I want to talk about is kind of like the obvious stuff, the stuff that we're doing. Starting with the street fair last year, where we were we were live. We had about 25 volunteers, well received. We had almost every political person that was running for anything showed up at our booth and were interviewed. We currently have a street fair planning group for this year's street fair so that we can do the exact same thing, only tweak it, because last year was really the first year we had done it that way. We are, our candidates' debates, our election coverage, we were live. It was a 9-camera shoot. And as you all know, it went for an extended period of time. And Katie was one of the on-air talent who had to stretch. So we had done that organization night, giving organizations an opportunity to tell something about themselves in a, just a little blurb and be, again, available on TV. Marcel's Reading Tales has now been, the dog show. It has been reformed to Canine Tales, and it is now currently being shown in 4 other communities, all with the tag from our, being at RCTV. So he's, expanded it beyond even what he thought he was going to do initially. We have our, you know, we're coming up to the summer, so we have our workshops, 1 and 2 week workshops, and we've created a new workshop this year, which I think is really interesting. It's a 2 week workshop. The first part of it is acting, and the other part of it is behind the scenes. And so they'll film, they'll edit, they'll do all the pieces of it, and then they're going to have a red carpet screening in August, which everyone's invited. So you get kids the opportunity to see both sides, not just the acting piece, but the behind the scenes piece as well. And we still have openings if anyone, you know, we still have openings. One of the things I really like about RCTV is that they have brought a lot of kids into the mix, middle school, high school kids. We had a 72-hour film festival last year. 3 teams participated, and that is you create, shoot, edit, and show. You've got 72 hours. So last year we did it for the first time, had a mixture of high school and middle school kids, and we had 3 teams. This year we did it and we had 6. So it's expanded. It's giving kids an opportunity, and we have kids that go through RCTV one way or the other and are going into the arts in college. They're, you know, looking both in front of the camera and behind the camera. And I have a friend of mine who's doing lighting and stuff like that, and he's gotten a lot of his experience at RCTV. The other thing I wanted you to know, we now, everything we produce is HD, and by the end is in HD, and by the end of the summer, both the conference room next door and the high school will also be shot in HD. So we're ready when Verizon and Comcast, thank you, say we can, when they take our feed, we can do it on HD, and we'll be ready by the end of the summer. The board just approved to upgrade the high school as well. Might as well do it in the summer when no one's there.
So they need to give you some new channels for that?
Yes, when they're ready. You know, we're ready for them so right. that they can, when we get to, you know, the contract is about, it's 1918 and they say, I mean, 2018, sorry. Mm-hmm. And they say about 3 years. So we're in that window where we need to start. So we're preparing ourselves so that we can, you know, go to the cable providers and say, we're ready, where are you? You know. Okay.
We think you would look very good on HDTV as opposed to...
A little more frightening.
Now I got to shave.
He really looks like that. While we're worried about the video, I can tell you from having watched school committee and finance committee activities at home that the audio track leaves a lot to be desired. I'm not sure where it originates from, whether it's the equipment selection or some ambient noise, but... Please don't fail to look at even the, you know, the simplest ability to pick up voice. I mean, yeah. It's one thing to see people, but if you can't hear it, seeing them doesn't really make much difference.
It's very important.
I mean, I was watching one FinCom event in the room next door. We occasionally were in there as well.
Right.
And it just sounded like a bad FBI sting where you could kind of barely pick it up on the audio.
Not that you'd know anything about it.
So the hearing issue is a big issue, especially as seniors. John, you're talking about seniors at home.
Thought he was talking about me.
No. You know, I do a lot of productions where I actually put subtitles in
sure.
as well, but sound is a big deal, and we continuously work on that. We continue to move things along. Now, one of the things that I'm really excited about is the on-demand services. You know, if someone wants to come home and watch the Selectmen's meeting and they're late to work, you know, they can watch it now. All meetings, you know, are now on YouTube as well. And I want to just point out where you access that through the website in a second. So all government meetings, if someone had something to do with the conservation meeting, they could go back one episode, all right, and they could look and see what happened at the meeting.
a number of other things, the 350th celebration, my personal favorite, the Save the Dummy movie out there, which is great. You can watch it. And so that's part of serving our community.
Yeah, one question on the meetings. When you're covering a live meeting, your web channel lineup does not always reflect the fact that there is or isn't a meeting that night. For instance, the Selectmen are shown every Tuesday as having a meeting. Well, we're not meeting on some Tuesdays. Is there a way to kind of make that more accurate so when people tune in, they're really going to see the Selectmen live and they don't
more
get...
More so I can DVR it.
Yeah. That's right.
Either way, yeah.
Well, and you know, that's really interesting. If you want to show the how to do it.
When it's good.
So we have recently... So in the television guide that is on your TV, what RCTV, our program guide is not there.
Right.
And we've sent letters both to Verizon and Comcast said, this is what we want. Comcast has not responded, and Verizon did that, and they said, it's not in your contract. Which, you know,
does everybody understand
but it
we're
will be.
About the channel guide?
Yes.
Let's find out when the conservation
well,
meeting
that,
is.
Well, that's
selected.
Fine and good, but your own listings are not accurate. So if you're going to be feeding them those, they're not accurate.
Well, here, again, we'd go up to programming, and then we'd take a look at the schedule.
Right.
Come down to the government, Selectmen right here, Tuesdays at 7 p.m. So we will change that. That is our job if there is not a meeting.
Okay.
Phil, what do we do if...
Ditto with the other boards.
If there's not a meeting that week.
So if you go up to programming and actually click
which one?
Government.
Government.
That would be the options. This comes out of our playback system, so when things are live, it's in there. So we just upgraded our playback system, so that might be why it's not loading. We purchased new equipment for our automated system. So I think that might be why the schedule is not updated on the website.
All right, and just to, because I know time is important here. Right here, again, rctv.org, and you go to videos right now for anything, you know, that's on demand.
Mm-hmm.
And here you could, the number of categories here on the left. We can go to our YouTube channel where you can get very specific. Now, all this, we want to get better and better, you know, with time. But you'd see the Selectmen's meetings. I think Chairman Ensinger's dog is there.
Yes, he is.
Well. would you all like to look at the dog show while we're here? Great show. So those are some of the things. Now, Reading is well ahead of almost all communities when it comes to some of the stuff that we're doing. As you guys know, we're located right on Main Street. We have an attractive facility. We also use it for functions, for birthday parties, for political get-togethers, other things, you know, we rent it out. That's our presentation. Certainly want to leave a little time for questions.
Questions, John.
A couple of thoughts, Kevin. On the YouTube channel, I've been frustrated in the past where I know it's recorded, I know it's in there, but it's not alphabetized or sorted in a consistent way. It's almost as if different persons titled the event that week, each subsequent week.
Yeah.
So unless there's a consistent way or you have... There's no way to find it unless you kind of already know where it is, or no ready way to find it, I should say.
Great. We'll take that down. Hearing it. We will work on that.
Okay. Any other comments?
I just had a comment from the superintendent of schools who couldn't be here tonight. We had met with you about a year and a half ago before and made some requests, and he wanted to give you some feedback that he's very happy with the coverage of meetings. Had far less complaints since we were in the senior board that long ago. He's really happy about that. He still laments the fact that you're not physically in the high school, because that allowed a lot more programming with the kids.
Mm-hmm.
So you know he understands with the staggered schedule of the high school that's difficult, but he does wish that somehow the school formally could work together with you. Not we know you offer things for the students. But the high school or the middle school would like to formally work with you if that's possible. They just asked me to pass that.
Absolutely.
That thought.
Great point. We would very much like some of the young people to get involved with RCTV. So you should know how things work better than us.
They're quicker learners.
No, I just want to say that my son has actually signed up for one of the summer workshops in TV production, so we're looking forward, as he's looking forward to that, so learning how to use all the equipment. It's a great resource. I don't know, I know we've all been down there, but just it's, you know, it's pretty sophisticated. It's not, you know, walking around with a VCR, you know, kind of video. It's really sophisticated stuff. So anybody out there that even has a middling interest in this, it's right in your downtown, and $20 gets you in. So it's a great resource.
Yes, thank you.
One last question.
Yeah.
Just looking at your financials, you guys are doing fairly well. We've got about half a million in cash in the bank. Do you have any ambitions for that in the near term?
Well, that is our rent liability fund, because, you know, depending upon our contract negotiations, RCTV assigned an obligation, and that is the way the accountant wants us to do it, to have a fund so that we could continue and pay our bills. You know.
This is your net assets have grown to almost over half a million. It's not on the liability side of the balance sheet.
I thought it was about $300,000 in the rent liability. I have the financials I'm going to hand out to you as well, to everybody.
Well, yeah, our official ones from our accountant. I think the ones that, because we have it audited every year, so.
There's no question it's in order. I'm just talking about the excess of revenues over expenses. You guys are doing extremely well. One thought is you might moderate your fees to pass that back, or have a
well,
plan for
everything we get though is the contracted from the Comcast and Verizon. We don't charge outside of the $20 membership fee. So we
feel like we're close to we're managing the money properly. You know, in other words,
that's not the comment. It's not about management. Okay. It's about.
Do we have plans?
Yeah.
Well, part of it was. To do the high school now as opposed to later. Part of it, Phil met with the IT department for the library and stuff, so we've got those expenditures coming at some point as well.
Do you have a capital plan that you kind of plan these things out?
We do.
Absolutely.
We do.
Much of that is money is committed to future products. Okay. Projects.
Thank you.
So I have, I have one quick question. Now, do you guys still have corporate memberships?
We
businesses
do.
Can you tell me a little bit about the rundown on that? So if a business in town wants to have a corporate membership, what does that mean? What does that cost? Are they communicated with? Is that a renewing fee, or is that a one-time fee? Just tell me a little bit about it, Kevin.
You know, to be honest with you, I think Phil, would you mind handling that, because I just don't want to misspeak about any aspect of it.
Our corporate membership right now, all sponsorships, and businesses can sponsor a program. For example, Premier Realty is a sponsor of Marcel Perkin in the Hills, and they have a deal for a little, it's like a trip, it's called a trip. Just, it says, you know, the following program is sponsored by Premier Realty with their logo, and there was a fee associated with that, and it was, given to the station, and they get to have their business tied to Marcel's program. We used to do a lot more sponsorships. We used to sponsor the Selectmen's meeting with like a local bank. We have gotten out of the habit of doing that because there is a lot of work associated with, you know, we have to shoot a commercial a sponsorship video, which takes up a lot of staff time, and then they become updated. And we had some instances of businesses sign up for sponsorships, we'd shoot an ad, and then they would close their doors. So it ended up being a lot of staff work for not a lot of return. So the format of what we're doing now with Marcel's program is the format we're moving forward with.
It's just really a question, Phil, tied to, you know, I've heard from some new Chamber of Commerce members and some, you know, people that have been in business for a long time, just wondering. It seemed as though there was a, kind of an active, corporate member. I thought it was a corporate membership, but maybe it was a sponsorship, and I just don't recall it, the correct. And I just, I think it's just valuable to know, because, I mean.
One show that is going to be coming back this fall is Adam's Game Show, and we are always looking for sponsors for that, because we like to do prizes for the winners, or you know, contribute to the organizations that they represent. Another program that we have coming out will actually focus on some businesses, restaurants, talk to, you know, Reading people who work here and help soft sell their businesses. In
kind of a chronicle idea?
Yep, like a magazine format.
It's a good point.
Every time we can get everybody participating in everything, usually good stuff happens. I just put that out there for whatever it's worth. You know.
Okay. Thanks very much. And we're on a continuous improvement process here, and we're happy to hear that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. We are now going to move on to the appointments of boards, committees, and commission. Just for the public's understanding, we have a volunteer appointment subcommittee that meets when we have new candidates, and they will often, when there are new candidates for a position, interview other incumbent members of the board. There are some incumbents they may choose not to interview, but they do all that in a subcommittee and bring their recommendations to us. So we are now making the actual appointments this evening, and these are for volunteer roles starting, for the most part, on July 1st, and for the most part extending 3 years. Last year we did go through the list, not one by one with separate motions, but just we did read them in blocks just so the people would know who was appointed. If that's your pleasure, we could do it that way. We could do it, you know, read a few and then move. But I think I'd like to read the names.
There's some mixing and matching here of incumbents and
right. Sure.
I mean, it's totally mixed and matched.
Yeah,
isn't that right?
Mixed and matched. Yes.
So maybe. I'll help you out.
You want to go through one?
You want to take, make his one motion in the block on the first page.
Okay.
And then I'll take the first half of the second page.
All right.
Sort of all the man if you want it.
Yeah. Move that the Board of Selectmen accept the recommendations of the volunteer appointment subcommittees as follows. The Audit Committee, Stephen Herrick, term ending 6/30/18. The Board of Appeals, Robert Redfern, term ending 6/30/18. And David Triniello, term ending 6/30/18. Board of Cemetery Trustees, William Brown and Mary Vincent, both term ending 6/30/18. For the Board of Health, Elizabeth Sherlin, with a term ending 6/30/18, and Nancy Doctor, with a term ending 6/30/16. For the Board of Registrars, Gloria Hulls, with a term ending 6/30/18. Celebration Committee, Kurt Habel, with a term ending 6/30/18. The Climate Advisory Committee, Joan Bogle, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
6/30, right. With a term ending 6/30/18, and Ray Porter, with a term ending 6/30/18. Also for the Climate Advisory Committee as associates, Michelle Benson and Gina Snyder, both terms ending 6/30/16. And the Commissioner of Trust Funds, Neil Cohen, for the term ending 6/30/18.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Any discussion? Again, my thanks to the VASC for doing some very important work here. Okay, I'll call for the vote. All in favor of those nominations? 5-0. Appointments, not nominations. Okay, I will move the Board of Selectmen accept the recommendation of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee as follows. To the Conservation Commission, Brian Sullivan for a term ending 6/30/18, Michael Flynn for a term ending 6/30/18, but effective 6/23/18.
15.
Yes. To Constable Thomas Freeman, term ending 6/30/18. Community Planning Development Commission, Jeffrey Hansen, term ending 6/30/18. CPDC Associate, George Katsoufis, term ending 6/30/16. To the Council on Aging, these are all terms ending 6/30/18. Thomas Procopio, Marilee Shapley, Margaret Havey, and Jolyn Eck. To the Council on Aging as associate members for terms ending 6/30/16 each, Pooja Parsons and Carol Leonard. To the Cultural Council for terms ending 6/30/18, Marianne Kozlowski, Julie Barber, and Jane Soloway, and for a term ending 6/30/16, that's a full membership, not an associate. Okay. Nora Bucko. To the Economic Development Commission, EDC, as associate member, John Russell, term ending 6/30/16. To the Fall Street Fair Committee, Brian Snell,
full member, 6/30/18, term ending. For the Fall Street Fair Committee as associate member, Allison Ullman for a term ending 6/30/16. The Historic District Commission for terms ending 6/30/18, Priscilla Poehler and Virginia Adams. To the Historical Commission, Charlene Reynolds Santo, term ending 6/30/18, and Jonathan Barnes, term ending 6/30/16. And to the Historical Commission as an associate member, Virginia Adams, term ending 6/30/16. Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
Yes. Now, some of these, I just want to clarify. I think that we think back to our visit. Some of these committees have open issues.
Yes.
So is what we have here everything that I'm trying to remember from the from our meeting, Kevin and Bob, you could probably speak up. I think that there are open issues that are unresolved.
You mean openings, or what do you mean by openings?
Well, I mean people that we haven't interviewed yet.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, yes. You know, correct. That's correct. Correct.
So, yeah. You know, what we're really acting on are essentially incumbents and those where there is a clear, we've interviewed everybody
right.
that's applied,
right.
and this is the outcome of that. However, there are in several cases that I'm thinking of here,
yeah.
openings that we're still
Fair enough.
Discussing.
Correct. That's,
yeah,
that's
we have to meet again in July and bring
right.
those folks back in.
Okay.
As I said earlier today, we wanted to be fair and not, since we were only able to do it on the VASC, that is the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee, was only able to do it on one night, you know, we just didn't think it was fair at the time
yeah.
to for folks that couldn't
sure.
get there that one night.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify because we did tell some people to be watch if they wanted to. They didn't need to come here, but they could
yeah.
watch.
Right.
Some of those people might be wondering why their names aren't being
called tonight.
Called
right.
or voted one way or the other.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's important for them to realize that the work's not finished.
Yeah.
This is
right.
the work that is finished. There's more to do. Okay. So just because your name wasn't read out does not mean that
right.
there wasn't a selection made,
right.
just that
right.
the work is incomplete.
Thanks for that comment, John. Any other discussion? I think we had a second on that motion.
We did.
All right, all in favor of that full page of candidates? The vote is 5-0. Kevin, you want to take the
yep. Move that the Board of Selectmen accept the recommendations of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittees as follows. Housing Authority, Richard Robbins for a term ending 6/30/20. RCTV Board of Directors, Kevin Walsh, a term ending 6/30/18. Recreation Committee, Daniel Foley and Nancy Lynn Swain with a term ending 6/30/18. Also for the Recreation Committee as associate member, Mary Ellen Stolecki with a term ending 6/30/16. The Town Forest Committee, Richard Weltzer and Kurt Havel, both with terms ending in 6/30/18. Also in the Town Forest Committee as associates, Nancy Doctor, Michael Bork, and Daniel Ford, all terms ending 6/30/16. The Trails Committee, Thomas Gardner and Gene Jacobs, with both terms ending 6/30/18. And also in the Trails Committee for an associate member, John Parsons, term ending 6/30/16.
Okay, your second.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Yeah. Just one comment, Tim.
Sure, Bob.
If you recall the recent vote at town meeting, there isn't actually now a maximum amount of associates that can be on board, so Town Forest is at their maximum.
Thanks.
Is it correct for me to say that some of these associates are in fact associates, others may not, may be people that we've approved to our observers only until the Attorney General signs off? Or have we covered all that?
Technically,
ground?
The associates that already exist do so through June 30th. The ones on this list who are new would exist July 1st or whenever the bylaw is passed by the AG.
So technically speaking, all these associates that we've just voted in for commencement beyond June 30th,
they don't exist.
Are really in a holding pattern.
Yes, they are.
They really will be attending
but they are welcome
as
to attend.
As observers from the public.
Right.
But the idea that as soon as there's a signature, we don't need to revisit this.
That's correct.
And we, and I guess town council says
that's
fine.
Town council was good either way. I said it'd be a lot easier if we could just do it in one meeting.
Yeah, it does make sense to get it done so that they're triggered right away.
Exactly. That's why specifically in your motion is not a start of the term, it's ending of the term.
Ending, right, got it.
John Arena.
Bob, at the time when the associate membership bylaw language was being hammered out, there was a series of discussions that related to the substitution element. If a standing member wasn't present, how would, by what mechanism, and would an associate be able to vote that evening? How would it be treated over multiple meetings, et cetera? And out of that, I think there was a discussion of putting forth a kind of a layman's guide to how that really works, separate from the bylaw codification. How did, where is that, or has that gone anywhere?
It hasn't gone anywhere. First, it needs to be approved. We never do any work till we have to.
Of course.
And secondly, as we'll discuss in the goals briefly later, there's a need to get together with boards and committees, either with just the town clerk to go over open meeting law and ethics, and possibly with the board to do things like this. So yes, there's absolutely a need, now that there's new rules for associate members, all the chairs and vice chairs have to know all that.
Right.
So you know, Laura has that as a task, but she hasn't completed it yet.
Thank you.
Yeah, good point. I think any kind of training that we are able to offer would be, I think, a great thing. Yeah, there's going to be a lot of questions on that. Oh, we just got caught up on the agenda here. Kevin, we have a hearing for a transfer of the liquor license. If you'd like to read the notice, please.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen, the town of Reading, hold a public hearing on June 23rd, 2015 at 8:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on the transfer of an all-alcohol package store liquor license from Athens Liquors, Inc., doing business as Square Liquors, to Raksha, Inc., at 13 High Street. Mm-hmm. Copy of the proposed document regarding the topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m. It is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on June 23rd, 2015 to the town manager at ci.reading.ma.us.
Thank you, Kevin.
Okay. If I might, Dan?
Yes.
Just before the applicant speaks, on pages 22 and 23 tonight of the packet, it's just a letter from the police chief and the police department saying everything's fine.
Right.
Okay.
Very good. Sir, could you please introduce yourself and the applicant?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Howard Rock. I'm an attorney. I have an office in Waltham at 465 Waverly Oaks Road. And I'm here this evening to represent Raksha, Inc. And with me this evening, I have Raksha Patel,
who is
100% owner of the business, and I also have this evening Chris Chomis, who is the current president of the corporation that owns the property Athens Liquors, DBA Square Liquors. So they'll be available for any questions that you might have regarding the process. Raksha is the sole owner on the corporation. She's 100% shareholder, and she is the president, treasurer, secretary, director of just a one person operation. I believe there was a purchase and sales agreement that was submitted with the package that
was received
previously. So you see all the details regarding it. She is going to be obtaining a loan from the local bank. She's going to encumber her property that's owned by she and her husband at 12 Benjamin Lane in Waltham. Reading Cooperative has agreed to a $300,000 loan on the property. So there'll be a loan to the corporation. There'll also be a second loan to be determined in the amount of the inventory that they'll be purchasing at the time of the transfer itself. This is Patel, lives here in Reading at 12 Benjamin Lane. She is a has been employed at JK Markets here in Reading, as well as the liquor store that's adjacent to it, which is now Ricky's Liquor Store. So she works right now approximately 5 hours a day, which she puts in somewhere in the vicinity of 30 hours a week at the store, so she does have some experience with the operation of this type of an establishment. She's also tips trained, and that expires in December. She'll be getting another one. She represents to the town that anyone that works for her will be certified with the beverage alcoholic training programs that are available to the liquor stores in the Commonwealth. She'll be working somewhere between 40 to 50 hours a week at the store. She'll be working Monday through Fridays and on weekends as needed. She is fortunately going to have the help of the current president of the corporation that's owned and he agreed to work some 4 to 5 hours a week, a day for a period of time during the transition. She's going to keep the at least one of the employees that's currently been there, a gentleman by the name of Michael, with about 3 years experience at the store, so he's familiar with the operation of that store and the general customers that you would see that are coming in. That's the background of Mrs. Rackshaw. She's not going to make any changes to the store. The way that the floor plan is set up right now, it will remain the same. There'll be no change to that. It's my understanding that currently there's no equipment that they can scan for driver's licenses and things of that nature for verification. They are going to purchase that type of equipment for the store to assist them. Anything else that's in existence at the store right now, such as pest control or any other operations like that, are also going to remain the same. So any questions that I can answer for you, I'd be happy to do so. And as I say, we have the proposed owner as well as the current owner of the property available.
Thank you. I'll go to the board first. John?
Counselor, does your client have a beneficial interest in either Ricky's Liquors or JK's Market?
She does not.
John, do you have your glasses up?
Yes, I did. Mm-hmm. So I thought I heard that Mrs. Patel lived in Waltham, and then I heard she lived in Reading. So
I live in my office is in Waltham.
Okay.
So if I said Waltham and referencing her, my mistake, I apologize. She lives
you're
in Reading.
In Reading.
Yes,
and
she lives
in
Reading
for some time.
Benjamin Lane.
Yeah. Yeah. We as part of the package also, there's some recommendations that were submitted as well that showed her history in the town and people that know her and not Charlie.
So the other question I have is, does the corporation have, will it have any other holdings other than this liquor store?
No.
Okay, that's it? It's,
yeah.
You know, created for the sole purpose of 100% ownership of this liquor store?
It was.
And nothing else?
Correct.
Okay.
Questions? Okay, none from the board. Any from the audience? It's a public hearing.
We say this, or I make a point of saying this to any applicant that comes before this board as it results, as it relates to the sale of alcoholic beverages or service of the public, that this board has historically taken a very dim view of any violations of service to minors. And we've taken some tremendous steps in the town around the general topic of substance abuse, but specifically around alcohol, our focus is on keeping it out of the hands of minors and ensuring that the store owner, that the business owner complies with identifying the age and proper status of any customer that comes before them. This material in tonight's package that we were given on Thursday that describes the policy that will be adopted, but I'd communicate to you and to your client directly that we would take a very dim view of any future violation of service to a minor. We've dealt pretty harshly with that in the past, and
we're both trying to knock it out, but also send a message that it's really not permissible.
Yeah, as a follow-on to that, actually, I'm guessing, and I don't mean to speak around you, but Mrs. Patel, I think you probably, based on what I just heard, were working in a liquor store where, and you were not implicated in what I'm going to talk about in any way, but you were working in a liquor store in this town where we had a significant problem, not once, not twice, but multiple occasions. And I'm sure you're well aware of, you know, how the board reacted. Yeah, I'm sure. And you know what? As I said, this is in no way casts any aspersions in your direction, but I think Mr. Arena's point is one that I'm sure you've embraced as you get ready to embark on ownership of such an establishment, you know, where this board stands on this. Yeah. I guess the, as a follow-on to that, you're going to be retaining, and now you're TIPS trained and will be renewing because it's going to expire, and I'm thrilled that you are, and I'm guessing that you're retaining an employee from the current ownership. Is that Michael, was it?
That's my understanding. That's
is he TIPS trained as well? Yeah. Great, good. Because, you know, that is a, that's a very important step as far as we're concerned, that energy and effort has right. gone in. Glad that you did it. As you know, we've had, you know, the opposite experience in the store that you worked in. Not everybody there was TIPS trained, and, you know, I can't point to cause and effect, but yeah. it was an interesting set of facts. So I'm very happy that you're embarking on a new business, and glad that you're in a complete understanding of where we all stand on this. So.
And I was very happy to hear in your presentation that they're going to be using ID checking equipment. I think that's very important. So good luck in your business. We hope we don't see you more than annually. Okay. Is there a motion to close the hearing if there are no further questions?
Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing and transfer of the liquor license from Athens Liquor Inc. to Rockshire.
Second.
All in favor closing the hearing? Motion.
Move the Board of
Yep.
Oh, almost.
Hang on, one second. Yeah.
You need one more vote.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the transfer of liquor license from Athens Liquor Inc. to Raksha Inc. doing business as Square Liquors, 13 High Street, subject to the following conditions: all bylaws, rules, and regulations of the Town of Reading and of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts shall be followed and subject to a satisfactory inspection of the establishment by the Town Manager or his designee.
Okay, is that seconded? Okay. Discussion?
Yes. There is a typo, not that it matters. It's Raksha, not Radshaw.
Yes, you're correct. Yep.
Yes. Very good.
First instance of it in the second paragraph.
Yep. Got it. Thank you, Mr. Arena. That is accepted as a friendly amendment. All in favor of the motion? 5-0. Congratulations and good luck.
Good luck.
Welcome.
Good luck
with your business.
Welcome.
Good luck with your retirement.
Great. Back to Greece.
All right. Okay. Anybody, we could do...
A little ahead, you want to do some minutes?
We can do minutes or we can proceed because this, I don't... Are we expecting attendance?
Could we do a very short break?
Let's do that, too.
Do that, too.
All right. Chair declares a five-minute break. We'll reconvene at 8:50.
I'm sorry.
We only got a couple.
Didn't have a couple.
No, we only got a couple.
There were five copies, two, but only four.
Everybody's starting to have it all.
Kevin, you're yellow only.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. All right.
And there's
four instances of that.
Shall we reconvene?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Okay. Board is called back to order. The next agenda item, we are going to review several boards and committees that are due to sunset on June 30th. Those being the Climate Advisory Committee, the Economic Development Committee, Fall Street Fair Committee, Human Relations Advisory Committee, and the Trails Committee. The way I like to do this, just to kind of get things done efficiently, but get everybody's viewpoints heard, we'll take these in order. I'll first entertain general discussion from the board regarding whether they should be continued, and if so, you may have an opinion about how long. But at the end of that discussion, I'm going to actually take a show of hands regarding one of these four dates here, just so we'll know how to craft a motion. Obviously, if a certain date doesn't have any support, there's no point crafting a motion for it. I'll make the rule that anything getting two or more votes will vote first for the higher approved number of years, and then the second highest if there's more than one that get more than two shows of hands.
That's two or more or three or more?
Two or more. So if I have a show of hands, you could be 2-2-1.
This is
one.
Just for the date, not...
Yeah, for the date. Just for the date, so we can do the motion.
So any date that receives two or more votes shall be the date of the...
Yeah, let's say motion. Climate Advisory, two people say 6/30/16, one says 6/30/17, two say 6/30/18. So we'll have motions first for 6/30/18. If that passes, that's it. If that fails, we'll go with the 1 year. 6/30.
So we're going, if, okay.
The greater extension first.
The greater extension first.
Because then there's no need to vote
right.
The other one.
Does anybody have any notes from when these folks came in last
yes,
time about their recommendation for how long they want?
I do, and I'll be happy to review that. Okay. So does that make sense? Then we'll actually vote on the motions down below. So first is Reading Climate Advisory Committee. My notes said they want to continue at least 2 years. I'll open it up to the board.
If I could just make a comment.
Sure.
Just so it's
yeah,
clear
you
for
first.
All of you.
Yep.
I did not receive any comments or emails or anything else from any of the board members or the public since the last time you guys discussed this. Just to be clear.
Nothing?
I interchanged a couple emails with Linda Snowdocks here on a couple of the points she made in the briefing. I think she cleared up my
Actually,
question.
I did talk to Linda, but... was nothing that was directed at the board, I guess.
I would have to say the same thing.
Are you all signed up?
I'm all signed
okay,
up.
Okay, I'll
that, I have heard from, mm-hmm. The only person I've heard from actually is Linda Snowdock.
Okay, let's hold that for the committee.
You know, and not necessarily in a selectman, you know, capacity.
Dan?
Yes.
Is there for discussion?
Yeah, there were just some discussion. About possibly having the Climate Advisory Committee go under the RMLD. I think they had a meeting with RMLD. I'm not sure that went anywhere. And they've expressed a desire to stay under us. So to that point, you want to discuss?
I do, actually. Just not specifically with climate advisory, but in general. A couple of thoughts. This has been rolling around in my head for the last 3 weeks, 4 weeks since we talked about this. First of all, the basic concept of sunsetting, which is writing an end of purpose date into the bylaw, I happen to think is a very good...
How rare is that in government?
It's a very good thing that you have a defined opportunity to say, is it still appropriate? Do you want to make changes? Does anyone know why the group is still here? Otherwise, government tends to perpetuate itself. And so sunsetting is a good thing. It doesn't mean the group's done bad work. It's simply an opportunity to reflect if it's an appropriate thing to make changes or continue what have you. And so my comments tonight aren't any more than reflecting the value of sunset and the opportunity we have in a sunset to maybe make some changes and bring something back if we choose to. With regard to, again, regard to all these committees, these are advisory committees.
Right.
They seek, they serve ostensibly from outward appearance to advise us or to act on our behalf based on direction we've given them.
Right.
And that's most evident with things like the Fall Street Fair, and that we have one of those generally once a year, and it's a ton of work, as Barry described earlier. And so there's a fairly good repertoire going back and forth in terms of purpose, you know, the mission of the group, the purpose of the group, the relevancy of the group, and what its intended purpose is this year. But I've been on this committee 3.5 years on the Board of Selectmen, and although various groups have been in front of us with some frequency, it's not been necessarily in an advisory role. In some cases, these are very well-intentioned groups with the, with tremendous passion on a topic, but in my view, they're not serving as an advisory group to our board. Rather, they seek to have a vehicle with which to serve the public. And as I think about these,
you know, hold your thought. I'm going to generalize the discussion. I think it might make sense to discuss all the boards so we can, if you want to do it that way. It sounds like that's where you're headed.
These are kind of preparatory comments.
That's
not with specificity to any of these groups, but just in general, with all of the committees that report to us.
Keep it general.
Is there still a purpose? Is there still a stated mission of the group? Is it our mission? Is this a purpose that we would have this group go forward and act on? And, you know, is there a closed loop where they come back and actually serve in an advisory capacity? So those are my comments.
Sure. John?
To that end, I think it's important and incumbent on us, because these are advisory committees, to give them a mission.
Absolutely.
I mean, I think we need to, we go to the, not the trouble, that's the wrong word. We have the exercise of creating, sunsetting, extending committees. And we have the exercise of having them come before us. But as advisory committees, you know, I think it's highly appropriate for them to come and say, we're interested in doing this. Is this something that would be valuable to the Board of Selectmen from the standpoint of, you know, advice? And I think that would be great to hear from them. I think it's incumbent on us to tell the committees what it is we're looking for.
Exactly.
You know, what is it we require in the way of their advice to us? And I think that that's, I just want to say in a general way, I think that's a really important thing, that we need to be proactive in what our expectations are from each and every
one. And maybe it's our bad that we haven't done more.
This is not throwing stones at anybody. This is just, I'm saying this in a general way.
Yeah, there's a bit of mea culpa here. I don't think that the board has been as active as it could have been, should have been, would have been under a different set of circumstances had these advisory responsibilities been better formulated. You know, is there a cadence where groups come before you? Is there a purpose? Is there a set of homework assignments? Is there a plan for this year or the next 3 years?
And for example, is there a time when the chairs and the vice chairs of all the committees that advise us gather, whether it's quarterly or semi-annually, so that they each know what the other one's charge is? I think things like this are really important to efficient operation of what we're trying to get done.
particularly as we move forward on a strategic plan. Everybody's got to be on one page, I guess is what I'm saying, and we're kind of the traffic cops.
Yes, sir.
And I think we need to accept and embrace that responsibility.
Any other general comments?
I think it's great that we have a lot of these committees, and at some point, these committees started because we formed them. There was a need at a particular time. I mean, if you look at something like Climate Advisory Committee, I know it started looking at things the town to do on things of climate change, but yet you look at some of the things that they've now done, you know, kind of morphed into things, you know, some really...
Some really positive things. Today things.
And I agree, John, it's good to take a, you know, kind of sometimes maybe hit the reset button, just say, hey, is this performing what we think it should do? Is it performing a valuable town service that we're, you know, obviously town government, I mean, town government, you know, the employees are not going to do everything, but is it filling a vital role? And, you know, we do that every 2-3 years and just sort of take its temperature again. A lot of the times, these things will kind of sunset themselves. If there's no interest in it anymore, they'll have a hard time pulling people together and having meetings. So, you know, but my overall view is if it does no harm, you know, that's a good thing. But also, if we have an agenda, we want to kind of convey that as well and have them advise us on the things that we feel are important. But I think all these committees play a valuable role. And you know, we'll vote on each one obviously individually. But I like the fact that we have volunteers. Passionate people in the community working on these things. So,
okay. Let's get more specific then. Kevin, do you have anything to add to that?
No.
Okay. The comments were on point, I thought.
I could just make a general comment also. There's another mea culpa, which I know I've said at least once in the past, that one of the reasons the boards aren't communicating well with each other is because the staff wasn't. Reason the staff wasn't is because many of them were part-time or shared or whatever.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've taken some steps in this year's budget to address that. And, you know, John Feudo and Jesse Wilson specifically in community development and community services are seeking to change that. That's where many of the volunteer boards are. And so there's a lot more, you know, discussions among staff. And that's how you start off getting the boards more comfortable and familiar with each other, is because the staff can then be a liaison with the boards. You know, and that just wasn't happening in the past. The things were just split off too thinly.
You know, sure. That is so clear. I spent some time down at the senior center, and I know that the reorg that, you know, was involved here with the elevation of both Jesse Wilson and John Feudo, it's clear to me is bearing fruit already. So, for example, I'll be at the senior center and I'll see people who I always, because I was liaison to recreation, I would see recreation staff being involved down there. I think that's really healthy.
You can tell that's what's happening.
And then it gets, I think, you know, as we see that to start to unfold in a very positive way, it makes it more incumbent on us to make sure that, obviously, public meeting laws is going to have an impact on some of these things, but you know, if you have the chair and the vice chair invited to a quarterly or semi-annual meeting of all of them, so we're all on one page, I think that there's a lot of value in that.
And also, we're liaisons as members of the board to all of. I mean, all these committees have an assigned board of selectmen liaison.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, we do have the opportunity to kind of go in there and 10 meetings and direct, yeah, not direct it, but kind of give a Board of Selectmen viewpoint.
Okay, specific comments, let's start with the Climate Advisory Committee. I want to start there.
So we have heard nothing from, we did hear from the Climate Advisory Committee.
They did come in, yeah.
They gave a brief.
We hear from them, you know, off and on, not off and on, I mean, on a fairly regular basis with what they're doing and what they're looking to do. It did seem, you know, when we first heard that
you know, maybe there's some, now that everybody can have committees, you know, should RMLD be involved, because they're so interactive with RMLD.
Yeah.
They felt, when they were here, no, they wanted to stay connected to us. Have we heard anything from our RMLD? Because I know that they, didn't they visit?
That was, yeah, one that meeting with them, I think.
Yeah, the chairman, the week before you met with these boards and committees, this was brought up at the RMLD meeting. I'm only hearing the second hand. RMLD board felt that they should stay under the selectmen, that they had no interest in acquiring them, if you will.
Okay. That simplifies things.
You know, it is absolutely true that functionally and operationally they do substantially a lot of their work with RMLD.
Space using, I mean, there's a lot of things.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, pick a number. 80% of what they do is very closely connected.
Yeah.
You know, and I do think that over time, some, you know, if a board was going to be formed today, I think RMLD would form it.
Now that
I think part of the list be education with specifically the trustees of the library, the school committee, and RMLD to get in this mindset of being engaged in their
public sector. I think that's a cultural breakthrough that we haven't,
yeah,
it hasn't kind of got through,
right,
all the board. You guys can have these committees.
Exactly.
And it's a good thing to have them. Here's how it can benefit you. Maybe we need to talk about it.
Well, and maybe the direction is more pointed when they're attached to a place that, yeah, you know, is more in their sweet spot. But, you know, I do think it's going to be a cultural breakthrough that's going to have to happen.
So just quick question in regards to that, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Logistically, how would that work? Let's say they did want to become RMLD. Is that something we would...
You give them some time with us, you know, mm-hmm, so they can nurture that relationship. You don't cut them off.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. How exactly does that mesh work? It's not something you would just let them sunset and let RMLD pick them up.
No.
Is it?
No. They'd probably have a discussion.
Well,
if
I would assume that if that were agreeable to all,
that's
we would
that's
know
the
that.
Premise
and that's not the case.
Right.
You know, you want to cut them off and sunset them, we'll quickly find out. I wouldn't recommend it.
No. That's my point more is,
it can't
is
really,
looking at the number of years they're looking to extend.
Unless you package a deal and meet jointly with RMLD, for instance,
mm-hmm,
and jointly discuss this topic
that's
and jointly vote on it,
right,
it's always going to be out of sync. You know, one does one thing, one does the other.
Isn't it true that a committee, we've had committees come to us at different times and ask us to consider sunsetting them?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, so... if we found ourselves in that situation, so let's say, for example, let's just use as an example, not that this is a suggestion, but an example. If the client advisory committee said, we'd like to be attached to you, we'd like to have that for 3 years, and we vote that, and then a year from now they discover that they and RMLD come to a conclusion that maybe this is better, and then we all work together on that, and they make a request, we sunset coincidental with, I think
that's how it works.
Yeah,
I think that's
work.
The way it could,
yeah,
be done.
Okay, absolutely.
And that's why I'm for extending the Climate Advisory Committee in general. I just was curious from a procedural standpoint if in the future they did, you know, change their minds and said, you know,
yeah,
maybe this is good. Just,
well, we don't take
prisoners. Want to see how that works.
Yeah. Yeah. No, we can sunset them if they request it, and then the other folks can pick them up. And
okay,
that may be the model that is pursued for more than one group here. I realize they have specific work to do under the Cities for Climate Protection Program. Do we have an outline of exactly what we signed up to in that?
Yeah, we do. It's on. They have their own website.
It's on their
website.
It's
pretty extensive, although,
yeah,
I haven't looked at it in at least 6 months.
So they have that, but in addition, they've done some really good emergency preparedness work that I think is of general use to the town.
And they're working with Jesse on solar. Power opportunities,
exactly,
with the light department. Yeah, they've got the recycling bin was supposed to come in today,
mm-hmm,
or tomorrow. I guess it wasn't in today, so maybe tomorrow.
So that's
so
on
its way.
Yeah, they're doing
stuff.
What did they request? 2 years, or did they request 3 years?
My notes said at least two.
Yeah, that's what I remember, at least.
And
two.
I wrote slightly revised guidance. That's my own notes. We might want to revisit this charter at some point. You know, expand it a bit. Some other things explicitly they've been looking at.
Yeah.
Is there anything else we think of?
So that's so. On the follow up to that, if we vote to extend any one of these committees today,
yes,
and we have a certain charter with them now, are we enjoined from waiting? We can change that, because they're our committee, right?
You can change that anytime you want.
Okay.
And they these groups come in periodically anyway to talk to us, correct?
Yes, at least quarterly.
This is the charter going to.
No, not that often. I'd say annually.
Pretty
well, they may, but in general, not necessarily.
Not more often.
And that's up to you. We could schedule them as often as you want.
I mean, you don't see historical coming. You don't see.
No, but again, as needed, certainly.
Everybody visits at least once. Others visit more often.
Yes, I'd say that's
as
right.
As needed or yes. As requested.
Yeah, we may visit them with liaisons far more frequently right. Than they visit us, but that's normal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. With regard to the Climate Advisory Committee, one area where I think their work has been more tangible for most citizens has been when they've talked about affecting or making a change in Reading. For example,
yes.
I still have this vivid memory of Gina Schneider when she, I think it was on town meeting floor, talked about rain gardens.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
As conversations exactly. Happened, the word came up 4 or 5 times in a 5-minute span. And mm-hmm. I could just see people in the audience, what's a rain garden? What's
yeah.
A rain?
Yeah.
And once she explained it was kind of this aha moment, but it was yeah. Tangible, actionable, and it was something that everyone could appreciate.
Right.
The group has grander aspirations than that, I understand that. But mm-hmm. In terms of a charter going forward, I would very much like to see their focus either on whether it be solar mm-hmm. Or we always have a problem communicating. It's more a rates issue than a conservation issue
right.
As it goes to water rates or consumption of any of these products that have a high fixed cost. They could actually help in that regard.
Sure, good.
I'd like to see, in addition to whatever their focus areas are, additional interest in kind of those tangible activities that touch Reading, whether it's rain barrels, and for a while there was rain barrels, people were gathering rainwater off the roofs, or there was I'm not sure it was them, there was a composting barrel that was distributed. I still have 2 of them in my backyard. Those are kind of tangible things that people get to immediately, and it's not so much this the grander scale of what's happening on a national level that's kind of
hard to get your arms around.
Hard for 01867 to figure out how to affect. Mm-hmm. I mean, so in terms of a charter or a mission change, that's one of the focus areas I'd ask to be incorporated in the next go-around.
I'd like to hear a lot more about emergency preparedness, and they certainly...
That's another example of that, yeah.
There's many causes that can necessitate that. I personally don't think the sea level's going to hit Reading anytime soon, but we could have storms, major issues, power failures, hacking of the power grid that turns the power off for weeks on end. Do we have a grab-and-go pack? That's something that's coming on the market now.
I'll tell you exactly what, during town meeting, I was having a conversation with one of them, and they said, you know, we're talking about emergency preparedness, and they had a presentation, and they had somebody at town meeting speak about it, and they were kind of frustrated that no one was acting on it. And I said, why don't you come up with an emergency preparedness package, which is, you know, a set of batteries, I'm making this up now, a set of batteries, drinking water, candy bars, stuff
food,
that's got
food
a lot
for two weeks, you know.
Whatever, but you can now brand it with your own name. You can get some focus in the group to distribute it, and I'm not sure it's going to be wildly successful, but it's tangible, it's actionable.
Sure. Okay. Well, we don't need to answer the question of changing the charter tonight. I think we're just here to decide to sunset or not to sunset. If not to sunset, how long do we renew for? So, any further thoughts on the Climate Advisory Committee? It sounds like I'm hearing consensus for extending them. Any other comments? You want to go to the straw poll on the dates?
I think let's go to the straw poll.
Want to do it? Okay.
Yeah.
6/30/2015, 0 votes. 6/30/2016, 0. 6/30/2017, 4 votes.
Five votes.
Okay, we are decided then. Kevin, do you want to make the motion?
Move to extend the Climate Advisory Committee to 6/30/17.
Is that seconded?
Second.
All in favor? Further discussion?
Nope.
Okay, all in favor? 5-0. Thank you. Economic Development Committee is next. Okay. Jack Russell sent the email. I don't know if that was in the packet tonight.
No,
again,
it wasn't.
It was the last one.
It effectively
gave, I thought, a lot of thoughtful suggestions about how to perhaps reform the EDC, reconstitute it. It gave a suggestion that it have a total of 5 members, including a commercial real estate broker, a developer, a selectman, interested and dedicated citizen, and either the director or nominee from the Reading North Reading Chamber of Commerce. I don't know if that'd be a conflict or not, but it might be a good idea if it's not a conflict. This is to maybe focus them more on, well, look at the MAPC discussions we've been having. We need a group that can perhaps be the local agent to facilitate that happening, or some version of the development that they're talking about.
I thought Jack's email was very well thought out.
It was.
I mean, I thought he, you know, and it, I don't know that he was necessarily submitting that with a consensus of all members of the committee.
Perhaps.
Maybe he was, maybe he wasn't. That wasn't clear.
It was copied to the committee, though. Yeah.
But, you know, I can say having seen, you know, the Economic Development Committee over, you know, an extended period of time, when they show up here, it's Jack.
Yeah.
And so, you know, even though he was an associate member, he does seem to, you know, take it. And I, as I said, I thought his email was very thoughtful and very concise. When he appeared here, he reiterated his feelings about that.
Mm-hmm.
I asked Jack a very direct question in this meeting, and that was, do you have any of these people on your board, and are you doing these things? He said no.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked him a question that might have sounded flippant. It wasn't intended to be. I said, Jack, are you suggesting that we fire everybody and start over? And he said yes. I mean, that was directly what happened here, you know, in this chamber. And so it makes me wonder if this might be one that we need to go back to the drawing board on and think it. I mean, clearly, you know, an economic development group, whatever it's called, is something that personally, I think, is really critical as we think about going forward, as we think about development, you know, in town, all of the things we looked at with MAPC. I mean, you know, we've got to do this right, and and it seems like the committee that we have had has gotten some good things done, but it's kind of almost more cultural than it is economic development. I'm not trying to label anything anywhere. I'm just trying to look at the body of work.
Yeah.
And when I asked their current chairman in this last meeting a similar question, I said,
we've never done any of that.
I said, have you done these things? He said, no, but we're excited about the prospects of it. Mm-hmm. And so it leaves me with a feeling that maybe it's time to dissolve and immediately go to work as a group here to, you know, and, you know, not only thank these people for their service, but think about how they could possibly be part of a newly, you know, reconstituted group. I just think it needs to be refreshed.
Yeah.
It clearly needs to be refreshed, refocused, redirected, repurposed. On the other hand, while we all get excited about the potential of different new development activities and things that are going to expand our tax base, and, you know, looking at pretty pictures, and I mean that brings people out, I really think it's important that we do not lose focus on taking care of the businesses that we already have. One of the things that that there always tends to be a tension, a push and a pull, is, you know, we're going to go out and recruit, you know, 5 new businesses in a new development that doesn't yet exist in Reading, and that's going to put 3 current members out of business. I think we really need to think that through. The other thing is that some of the things that they're doing, you know, are, you know, a lot of some blocking and tackling on taking care of current business. The meeting I went to, got there late. They were in the middle of pouring through applications to get some money to help current businesses, you know, with their signage. I mean, is that as exciting as, you know, bringing in a new development into a new development parcel? No. But does it play a vital role? I think so. So I think that while we're going to reconstitute it and redirect it, I think we need to pay attention to, see, to some of the things that they're already doing that we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. So whether that's done as part of a new economic development committee that we may name something else, I think we need to look at sort of the functions that are currently being done. And if we do vote tonight to discontinue them, you know, that we want to just make sure that some of the things that they're doing just don't get lost until we figure out the next thing. And
the chair made a good point, and you're both right. Carl Weld said, why not split the group into an inward and outward focus?
Yeah.
Exactly what you're saying. Let's keep part of that group charged with focusing on this, their wellness to the degree they can. And the other really has to, you know, be the cheerleader, the marketing assistance folks, working with MAPC and others. Yes.
Dan, this is one where I think where the group that is in place has done a reasonable job with the resources and time they have. But as even they've described, it's a monumental task for a volunteer organization of their size and the turnover and attrition that happens in any volunteer group. Our task is to develop the charter for what comes next. What will the top five things be that that group has to go off and do? Barry's point's well taken. If there's good that comes out of the current group, those tasks, those bodies of work can be continued going forward. But I think in this specific one, we're trying to build a different group that has a larger charter and a larger purpose and arguably a larger, more, maybe it's more people, maybe it's different types of people with different skills mix, but you kind of build it with a purpose in mind as opposed to working at the scale that the current group's been able to achieve over these years. So I'd be, just to get it out on the table, I'd be inclined on this one to take a pause, get the board back together, design a economic development committee, business development committee 2.0, and let's decide what that is and bring it forth at a suitable time.
Interesting side note. Reading once had an industrial development committee. I know I was on it. It's back in the 80s. We were charged specifically with marketing the landfill area. Right. That group got absorbed into what is now CPDC, along with the planning board and the board of survey. So there's actually a component of CPDC that's charged with development, being proponents of development.
Would you view that as having been successful? I obviously, the landfill's gone.
I think it got lost in the sauce in CPDC. The regulatory side, I think, has consumed a lot of their activity, just out of sheer necessity. I don't think they've had the bandwidth to be an IDC.
Yeah, I wouldn't put that task with CPDC.
It was a little bit of a strange.
Yeah.
It's like, remember the old Atomic Energy Committee? It would both promote and regulate atomic energy. That never quite worked.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, that kind of screams to the issue of something that has come up earlier, and that is we need to take an active role in what it is we're looking for here. And you know, that we need to take on that responsibility. And, you know, interestingly, in the case of this particular committee, the fact that they had one member step forward who was an active member who kind of laid out a game plan of thoughts that was circulated among everyone on that committee. There didn't seem to be any, I saw no dissension from that suggestion. I actually thought that could be a good basis for where do we go from here. I think, Barry, your point is well taken, that we don't want to throw, you know, the baby out with the bathwater. Those things that are working well, we should continue to do. But I think they almost, we need to figure out where they fit and how they fit, and how is staff being used. I mean, staff time is at a premium, and the more of these committees that we have that don't have crystal clear direction, we're burning, you know, the scarce and valuable staff time. My thought here is that I would suggest that we let this sunset and then take an active role, either a subcommittee of two of us to come back and report or something like that?
Actually, I think it's going to be, frankly, I think this Board of Selectmen should be the Economic Development Committee for a little bit of time, and then...
I disagree with that.
It's really, I mean...
It will be as part of Reading 2020. This will become one of the work products.
That's where it's synchronized.
Right. I mean, because we're the ones that are going to have to...
We need to sell the town.
Right.
You know, it's that simple, and you know...
How much do you think we can get?
At the rate the houses are going.
I'll place it up for you.
To the billions.
I know.
What's the commission?
Yes, are you finished?
No, I'm done.
Okay.
Yes.
Real quickly, in regards to this, too, I think one of the things, I agree with all of my fellow board members here tonight with what they're saying. And I certainly, thank the people that have put in a lot of effort on this committee to this point. They really, have done a lot to try to work on what they were charged with at the time. I think part of what we should be looking at moving forward is what everyone's kind of thinking. What are we charging them with in the future? And quite frankly, the way this is constructed, is this the most efficient way to handle that? And I think that second part of it is something we really need to focus on. What is the most efficient way moving forward that we want to handle economic development in this town? Do we want to have staff devoted to it? Do we want to look at some kind of private-public partnership with it as well, too? I think there's a lot of aspects that are out there that, I don't think we're going to be redoing the wheel in this case. I think there's some other towns and cities that we can probably pull from to see how they've done it and what the results have been that we can certainly use in compiling and say, hey, this is what's worked, this is what hasn't worked, this is what we want to work, and kind of use that structure to try to come up with the best plan forward for a committee or some type of committee in regards to that.
Yeah. Yes.
Bob, I have a question for you. I mean, I know you, the board and FinCom and the school, we've all sort of developed kind of like, well, if we had $1 million, is this, given the discussion and given a lot of the energy that's going into sort of economic development, do you envision or can think about an add to staff in the planning department that basically would be charged with, not single-handedly, but pulling this together? I mean, does it make sense to look
In the budget that was, pardon me, submitted at town meeting, I had a 3-year look ahead or something.
Yeah, I remember
it.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what to call it because I'm not a professional and I didn't ask them. So I called it a long-term planner. I don't know what it is, but it's exactly what you guys are talking about. And I will just echo John Halsey's comments that staff time is scarce.
It is.
And that's just something we got to always keep in mind. I don't want to burn out staff. We have really good staff in lots of areas here. And that's just in the back of everyone's mind. It's great to have volunteers that are excited. We do have a limiting factor on how much we can help them. It's just a fact.
Well, they will lose their excitement if they're not supported. And if you spread your staff too thin,
right,
they're going to go someplace else.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what will happen.
It's a balancing act, no question.
I mean, so, and we need to help. We need to work closely with you on that. That's why I think, your idea, Barry, around this, that we all kind of rallied, the six of us actually rallied together around the right way to go forward around this very important topic, and maybe fill the void in the short term. Until we figure out what we want, and then take under advisement some of the suggestions that came out of one of the members, and see where we go with it. And Bob certainly has already, in a forward-thinking way, no surprise, thought about a staff person that's committed, so you don't end up burning out the people who have 14 other things.
Yeah, and in regards to that too, if you really lay out a plan for, your future planner, what'd you call it?
Long-term
planner, even better.
We got to change that name.
Oh, I know.
Yeah. In regards to what you were saying, if we had $1 million, great. Adding a staff person obviously adds more money to our operating expenses, but there's also, we need to make sure that we don't just look at it in that term, but we also look at it as a net term. Right. So, yes, we're adding money to it, but we can justify it because of what we're going to have them charged with.
That value proposition of, theory is you add a fixed expense to create a variable income.
Right. So your net could be a gain.
and that person could be dedicated to this, a new committee.
And you can't rule out the possibility of them getting some grant aid to fund their, I mean, does MAPC or any other agency in the state offer some incentives to...
There's been pickings around there.
Secretary Ash loves
maybe,
us.
Maybe a little tough now, but it's worth it.
He loves me, Adam.
Leave no stone unturned.
Maybe we could put in his ear that there's a good way to roll out a new test plan.
We've tried.
So, Bob, would you foresee putting this in the 16 budget? No, what are we in now?
We're in the
17.
I already have a higher priority that the superintendent and I have discussed for November. It's much more important than this, honestly. But this is in the next group. Mm-hmm. And I think it needs a lot more fleshing out before you just say, yeah, we need to solve this, call it this, and everything's fixed.
Absolutely.
No, we really need to go ground up.
Yeah. Yes.
What is the charge of this person? How do they fit in? What boards and committees do you have? Until it becomes so obvious to everyone that, yeah, this is a real strong need.
Yeah.
Plus, we have business cards now. So.
And unlike many other roles in the town, this will actually be more of a cross-functional team where they're actually working across the various silos in the town to coordinate our look and how we appear to the outside.
And if I might, with Matt here in communications, I think we have a much more opportunity to use leverage. Matt's not going to do this work.
No.
But he's a great resource for a person that would come in to help them get the maximum bang on the buck.
Sure.
Are we? We haven't scheduled our Saturday.
No, not yet.
This is topic one.
I'm trying to think.
There's a few 1As here.
There's a few ones, Barry.
I think I had about 15 of those.
Yeah, that's for later.
All
right. I will say we've had some presentations lately. That informal cultural group met.
Right.
I can't remember, 1 or 2 weeks ago, and we had a presentation by. I'm going to forget the community, so I'm not going to say. She started in a community and started a Main Street program. And she's now working in another community. But just to be, just throw an option out there, this is completely, quasi-public-private joint effort. But, you know, she was hired as a staff person, part-time, then full-time, by the business community.
I think you're thinking of Beverly, maybe.
Yeah, it is, but I didn't want to say.
Oh, okay.
That's okay.
Thanks, Kevin.
She's somewhere else now. This has been in existence for 15 or 20 years. And, you know, nothing against them, but my observation was, wow, if that's where you are in 50 to 20 years, that's a lot of work that is needed. So they do a really nice job, but it's still a relatively small operation now. Obviously, they're also a small community. But they found in their model they got much more done not being part of the government. So there's no one answer to that. Mm-hmm. Every community is going to be a little different. Usually in grants, better to be a local government.
Sure.
Usually in flexibility and speed, better to be not associated with the government. But I think the best of all worlds is you find your stakeholders and you have a long discussion about the pluses and minuses, and you try to grab from each. Try to do a little of this and a little of that.
Yeah,
if it works.
A little bit of the partnership.
Yeah.
Okay. Further discussion on the EDC, or are we ready for a straw poll?
Yes.
All right. EDC. 6/30/2015, which would mean sunsetting. All in favor? There we have it. Should we make this motion?
I don't think we have to.
No,
you don't have to.
Right. I mean, you can.
Well, that's more definitive.
You could move to sunset.
Before we formally sunset, I think there's a function that the EDC has that I think we really need to kind of flesh out.
Flowers.
Just also they control part per their. Per guidelines, don't they control the diet?
Well, that's an interesting situation.
The current town managers
kind of look the other way. Technically, the town manager is in charge of all that, and they're not supposed to be spending money, but they have been.
Mm-hmm.
That's okay. So
I thought they were defunded.
The exact wording of the motion in front of town meeting, which we'll have to ask town council if you guys sunset them, do we need to change it, was town manager under the guidance of economic development. But they did not have the authority to spend money.
So how is it currently written now?
Something like town manager under the guidance, whatever the word is, of the economic development.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was.
Right.
So the
guidance will be missing.
Yeah.
You guys can do it.
There's a pot of money that can go for some good things. And
yeah, and we should talk about, you know, if you want to fill a role, which I think is really an interesting idea. What kind of things do you want to do? Here's the money. Let's go. Let's have a discussion. I don't doubt they've been doing some good things with the money. But I don't know enough to really say a lot about it because I've only been to a handful of meetings. But we don't need, there's no legal, now I haven't asked town council, but there doesn't appear to be any legal problem to me since the town manager's office is the spending authority.
Right.
It's just there's going to be a different advisory group. And if we need to get some language at town meeting, that's not hard to do.
I would just like to see the funds dedicated for the things that they were doing so there's a clear path.
Mm-hmm.
Because from what I understand, don't those funds come from the town, from the fall fair, or a chunk?
Indirectly through the diet. All have to be hashed out
right.
and discussed.
So,
yeah, and if there's any future business that they have, we certainly don't want to cut off business owners in the process.
They are familiar with certainly the.
They were voting
on
two
meeting,
things
so.
the night that I was there.
Yeah.
Not a week ago, so I mean they were.
I just want to make sure. Yeah, I want
to
make sure
no one's cut
them
off.
Businesses that are in the middle.
We just
of
have
the,
to.
Okay.
We, and
okay.
Certainly, we have to. I think we have to honor activities that are underway.
Yeah.
Honor commitments.
What's unclear to me is, I know that they don't have a budget.
Right.
But you know, I know they're spending money. So we really need that. We need to get that into the right compartment so that we
yeah.
can honor the work that's being done for sure. Figure out how to continue the work
mm-hmm.
That's good work, you know. And you know, I mean, one of the things you know has been for a long time. You know, money flowed in from the. I don't know if it actually ever flowed from the Fall Street Fair
into
EDC
the diet
to spend the. You know, so for example, to you know, buy flowers, water. And I'm not suggesting that's a bad thing. I mean, there's a certain mechanical transaction
yeah.
that we have to really look at and make sure we're getting it right. I mean, I'm not suggesting we abandon the good work at all.
Yes.
I guess the only caveat is to understand what's in flight, and that we don't interrupt any decision that's been made
or commitments that were made.
Right,
right.
Yeah, I'm not anticipating a problem.
Yeah, and
first of all, they're not making enormous commitments.
Yeah, I mean, it's
yeah,
we're talking about $500 and $800 at a time.
Jesse could source those.
No,
she
was,
right?
that.
Yeah. Were, no, the meeting I went to, they were,
thousand.
It was, I think, up to 5,000 on one business
yeah.
and a couple of thousand on another,
yep.
you know, based on proposals that people went out and did and got bids, and
mm-hmm.
it wasn't something they were just handing it out. It was
yeah.
well thought out stuff. I mean, just
I know there's been a lot of discussion. I'm not familiar with specific cases, but I know they don't just, oh, good, another application. Here's your money. There's a lot of discussion.
In fact, actually, to their credit, you know, while I was there, you know, thinking that might be their last meeting. I mean, they had, there was money in there, and they were very strict about, well, you know, there's nothing that says we can't, to one applicant, give, you know, $15,000 because basically it's a 50-50%. So it comes with a $30,000 proposition. They could give, even though technically there was nothing written that said they could do it. They were very careful about making sure that they left that to the next
yeah.
group, whatever it looked like or whatever
yeah.
it was called. They were careful about that legacy. So I think we should think through how we're going to want to do that.
If I might, if the board is, I don't mean to jump ahead, but if the board is interested in filling that role, I suggest we bring in the town accountant and probably town council and make sure to set up whatever vehicles. And I'm not saying they were done wrong in the past, but we better take a
yeah.
look at that too.
Absolutely.
You know,
yeah.
look at the diet, make sure it's operating properly. And I would honestly say it's the same thing about any of our funds. It's time we really had a look at those.
In terms of voting a motion, we can either not do anything, which strikes me as kind of passive aggressive.
Yeah, I think we should.
Aren't we extending them to a date they're already?
Well, you could say move to sunset
could,
them as of.
Right.
You
okay.
Change the motion that
yep.
way. Do you want to do that?
Move to sunset the Economic Development Committee with the Board of Selectmen's thanks.
Yes.
Yeah, I think we should figure out a way to really thank them. I mean, there was a nine. Some of those people were on the
yeah,
8-9 years.
Well,
I mean,
and there are people that aren't there with it any longer as well. That have moved on and gone on other things.
Right. We should get everybody's name and do a little ceremony. We'll make that motion, sir.
Move to sunset the Economic Development Committee with the Board of Selectmen's thanks as of 6:30:15.
Second.
discussion? All in favor? It's 5-0. Okay, Fall Street Fair Committee. Now they, let's see. I think Brian Snell was in talking to us. He suggested an interesting timing here. Either we go in half year,
yeah,
and then full year increments from that point, just so they can get through.
Yeah, the December end date for them is much more logical.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's when everything starts.
Yeah,
is
yeah.
January 1.
I said a minimum
by
of
December,
one.
They've wrapped up financially their Fall Street Fair. Take a few months off, start in the spring.
I think they said they wanted to get through what, three
this one?
Three fairs is what
three
they
fairs,
are.
Right.
When
so
I did the
and a half years?
The little
so that's
walk
2017.
Through
here.
That's yeah. 2017 would be
12,
three, street,
yeah.
three
yeah.
Fall Street fairs, right?
12/31/2017.
Right.
Is everybody happy with that? We need to really kick that around a whole lot.
I don't, you know, that's what they asked for.
Right.
I mean, this is
yeah.
a premier event.
Right.
Yeah.
They do great work. I don't, for my money,
it's
I want to give them what they ask for.
Right.
My
oh,
only
and that reminds me,
yes.
by the way, when I was at that meeting, they invited the Board of Selectmen to have a booth.
Dunk booth, maybe.
At the
sure was a dunk fair.
So
well, I wasn't.
I listening. Actually, it skipped my mind when I did my my liaison report. So,
well,
I think they said they give it to us for free. Although
I,
they're watching.
I think
they'll
that's
call
right.
in.
that could be an that could be real high level entertainment.
didn't say commit us to what will be happen at the booth, but.
If they, I think that's not a bad idea if we can get
involved. Water and fire.
No dunk.
Is that where they want to put the dunk tank? Is that what you're telling me?
It was undefined.
Yeah. But the only reason I would even think of not having them under us is if they deemed it better to their operating practices to go private for just doing the basic business under other than the open meeting law, which is a real pain in the neck for them sometimes. But if they feel they can go on,
I think part of that was they wanted to figure that out as they were
yeah.
as they were doing this.
Okay.
I think that was kind yeah. of part of their want to get three more.
And you know, one of the things that you know, as we talk about the Fall Street Fair, and I actually raised this informally with their current chairman, which is Brian.
Brian, yeah.
Today, you know, we had talked, Kevin, when we were. Interviewing, there's still one person to interview, that's why we really couldn't finalize, and there really was only one spot, but there were two or three people, all anxious and eager, and you know, the idea of two or three associates there makes so much sense, either that or expand the committee.
Bring up the next
and you know, when I brought, the, when I brought that up to Brian, he went, well, if we expand the committee, then are we, you know, what's happening to the quorum call?
Yeah, but you're going to have more associates. So
exactly. So, you know, I mean, one of the things for discussion with them, I think, that's very important after today, I think we need to give them what they're, personally, I think we need to give them what they're looking for, and then engage them in a discussion. I mean, if you added two regular members, now they get seven. I mean, they got a big job. There's a lot of work that goes into their job. You raise their quorum call by one, but now you've got more opportunity for more associates.
Right.
And you know,
how many are on there?
There's only five.
Five.
Meeting, how's that? There's like 10, 12 people around.
There is, so always, but there's only five.
Members. Five voting
yeah.
members.
And
yeah.
so that's therein lies the problem. You've got to get three of those
yeah.
every
oh,
time they get together. And this
yeah.
is why they visited us a year ago and said, you know, maybe you should just dissolve us now.
Yeah.
So we're not constantly struggling against the public
yeah.
meeting laws. And so, you know, I mean, it was not a decision made to do that. But, you know, I mean, they had actually brought it up.
Yep.
But I do think that one of the things from an advisory standpoint, Ken, this is an advisory committee of ours, and I mentioned it to their chair, and he said he'd think about it, and I think we should discuss with him the fact that maybe more hands there makes
yeah.
the job easier, opens up more associate opportunities, and actually those people are probably already exist.
Yeah, exactly.
Right there.
It's not like you're out looking for people.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So,
show of hands.
Show of hands. 6/30/2015 for the Fall Street Fair. None. 12/31/2015. None. 12/31/2016. 12/31/2017. 4, 12/31/2018. 1. All right, I'll entertain a motion with 12/31/2017.
Move to extend the Fall Street Fair Committee to 12/31/2017.
That's seconded.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? 5-0. Okay, Human Relations Advisory Committee. Now, the school committee did have some discussions about whether or not they never got to that point.
I'm not aware of them having discussion in open session anyways. I'm sure Linda being one of them has talked informally.
Right. Clearly they're doing some very important work in town. The only question I have is their mission sufficiently aligned with the board to continue on a long-term basis, or would they be better off even either under the school committee or possibly an outside party like the Reading Clergy Association?
Well, which also there are other towns that actually have such a committee, but it's handled privately.
By a clergy association or by somebody else?
Not, that's unclear to me, but yeah. I mean, look, I think that we need to, personally, I think we need to give them time to figure themselves out.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I think if we feel like they're doing good work, but it's not connected directly, then that's shame on us. I think we need to let them know what it is that we're hoping for. They can tell us what they'd like to do, and then we figure this out.
Yeah, I mean, if anything, events of the last week dictate, you can never have enough engagement on a local level about respect and about just human dignity that, you know, I mean, obviously we don't have that issue, but it could happen anywhere. And I just think just the more you talk about it, the more you engage people, the more you just say this is not acceptable.
It almost, though, needs to take a, you know, see something, say something. Because apparently this individual is showing signs, and
but that's out of scope, though, Dan. I mean, the question is, in our
That's why I raised the point. Yeah. You think it is? I don't know.
I mean, I can't tell you today what the message is that the group. I'm sure that they're passionate. I'm sure that they have the absolute best of intentions. I recognize the group was birthed out of the original Bill Russell episode of the '60s, I guess. Yeah. But I can't tell you today, mostly because we failed in our responsibility to guide them and provide input as to what we wanted from the group. So they're kind of using us as a, I think, to execute their own mission, but I couldn't tell you today exactly what it is. It's that's really the disconnect, and I think this is one of the groups in my mind. I'd like to have them back and talk about what it would be going forward on in a coming year. You know, it's kind of a tune-up.
I mean, that's what they talked about too when they were here.
Linda talked about at least 2-year extension.
Yeah,
it was in her letter.
Yeah.
I have it here.
Also, about
which one of us has the liaison there?
I think I am.
I don't know if I brought that. I thought I was bringing it.
I'm not this year.
I'm just thinking that it could be more productive in a subcommittee type of thing, either, you know, John, if you're the liaison, I mean, let's go figure it out.
Yeah.
For us to do that here with 6 or 7 people is going to be, I don't know if we're going to get there. I mean, I think what we need to do is we need to decide what we're looking for, direct them. They need to hear that. They need to say, have you thought about this? Because we think this is also important. And then, you know, we get a mission. So that it's clear, and then that'll give them the opportunity to figure out, are they better off working with us, working with the school committee, or as a private, you know, committee.
I think that's what Linda, when she was in here, was especially looking for. I think they were looking for, you know, genuine guidance from us that, you know, would give them a clearer mission maybe, and they were certainly open to exploring what's the best way to accomplish that mission.
Yeah.
So was she looking for 2 years? Is that what your notes say?
I think she said 2 years.
Yeah, I'll read the letter precisely. It said, as the HRAC approaches its sunset deadline, we write to request a renewal of the committee for at least 2 years beyond June 2015.
Plus, I think they've got some recruiting to do. I know that they've got
some. We talked about that, about trying to expand. But I think once they figure out.
They had a resignation. Camille's resigned.
I saw that. What they're going to do and their mission is, I think that'll help in the recruiting.
Yes. So I agree with that.
I'm just going to add, I'm pretty sure I believe they're down to just a quorum. So that everyone has to go to a meeting in order to have a meeting.
Yeah.
So it would be good to, if you're going to continue them, to absolutely find new members.
Well, you know, yeah, we'll have to see what, I think you got to see how that plays out.
So just a question, I know that the VASC has met, but, you know, let's say you have a need to.
We can meet as much as we need.
We can meet
so
once a week.
It's not a once a year.
We can meet as much as we need to.
So if they, find five people that want to.
We had one person that was.
Somebody and set up a meeting. We need 48 hours notice to do so.
Okay.
And you will meet before your next meeting.
Yes, we will. That's right.
Okay.
It's actually, I think Kevin and I talked about it being our intention, because there are some loose ends from the last meeting that we want to have this happen sooner probably than later.
Yeah.
Right. So. All right. I mean, there was specifically on the Fall Street Fair, there's some loose ends, and we want to help them get to it as quickly as we can.
Definitely going to help them get that as fast as we can.
All right, we ready for the poll?
So.
Okay, 6/30/2015, 6/30/2016, 6/30/2017. Okay, let's have a motion.
By the way, Dan, Kevin is the liaison. I stand corrected.
Oh, I was.
No, you sit revised.
Okay.
Revised, they said.
Move to extend the Human Relations Advisory Committee to 6/30/17.
It's a tough crowd.
Listen, I'm chair. Are you going to listen to my
camera? I don't even understand the dialogue.
It's an old Jonathan Edwards joke. Our former town planner.
Okay.
Okay. Second on that?
Second.
Okay. Discussion. All in favor? 5-0. We are extended. Trails Committee. This is almost a no-brainer.
These folks have been doing some really good work.
Yep.
Yeah.
38 Kane grants to date. They have obtained.
Do they have a preference?
Forever.
I think they want to go forever.
I think it's our preference.
I think they said 3 years.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any objection to that? We just go for the motion.
Absolutely.
I think we need to discuss that. I think they're doing awesome work. And they have a mission. They're doing good work. It's aligned with what we do. There's no question. Yeah.
The only thing that I just couldn't understand, and we asked him specifically, was sort of, you know, kind of blending in with the forest, the town forest committee, and
it's more
they were clearly, like, they didn't want to do it, but it seemed like there was sort of
Bob explained it. There's like, the charter kind of got in the way of doing it that way.
Yeah, the charter does get in the way, and interestingly, even though some of the members are in common, they don't want to.
They don't want it to go.
Maybe it's two nights out.
VASC,
I don't know.
We interviewed people that were on.
That's right. It's a gentleman
and
that was on
like,
both.
No,
and
yeah,
absolutely.
Like it
didn't
the
want
way
to
it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's all more meetings they have to go to.
They can knock themselves. They're attending the meeting.
Maybe they're having them in the woods. It's
good.
Oh, I'd be all over that. I think that's a great idea.
We have a motion.
That's fine. That's good. I'm good.
Move to extend the Trails Committee to 6/30/2018.
Seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Okay.
Thank you, gentlemen. Good discussion, good debate. Let's do the minutes last. Okay, we're now moving on to the town manager's annual review. Just to set this up.
Did you put this in here?
Yeah, there's some additional material in the packet tonight. So while I'm talking, you guys might want to flip through beginning with.
Sent it to us too, right?
Yeah. It starts at page 24. Yeah, 24 in the packet. 24, 25, 24 through 29 is our evaluation form that we used last year. Four of the five selectmen opined, and that is all summarized there. So what we did was take goals that the board agreed for with Bob under, I think, six or seven major categories: administration, regulation, policy development, services, et cetera. There were specific goals and objectives developed underneath each, and a rating was assigned by each selectman, and then a composite rating I worked out, or the chair worked out the guy who worked it out. I think you and I did that. John and I were on a subcommittee last year. So that's how we did it. Now, what Bob has also provided some other formats here. Used the Massachusetts Model System for Educator Evaluation. There may be elements of that that we can bring to bear here, although it is, you know, there obviously there's a lot of things very specific to being a superintendent. There may well be some more general aspects. The one thing I think was missing last year was we did not have categories for quality of management, and I think that's what Bob may be willing to work with us on. How do you do the management thing? How well is that happening? How's your delegation? How's your management style? How's that working with the employees? Retention, hiring practices, things of that kind. So what I think I'm going to be looking to do is sort of forming a committee of two, and I'll be one of the two, to take a look across all these other suggested formats in addition to the one we used last year, find ways of improving that part if necessary, with the current goals. And I think this year's goals are also attached back here somewhere.
They're in there somewhere. They're in tonight's.
They're in the back.
In the back.
When were the goals established?
Before you came on.
No, I know. That's
what they were. They were actually discussed over several months and formalized maybe in like August, September, October.
It was October. I remember the reason why I'm not on here is because October 4th, my son was born. That's why there's no comments from me last year. I gave you a brief, I think, 30-second.
Well, here's another thought. The school committee just did this. They're actually asking Mr. Caruso to contribute his thoughts, because he was there for the full last year. He's actually agreed to do that. Although Barry is absolutely welcome, and he's going to be part of this, but we might also want to ask Marcy if she would be interested. Can't hurt. I mean,
It's actually interesting to have six-person.
Why not?
Start a basketball team.
Yeah. If you have no objection.
No, I have no objection.
So I have a question really more directed to you, Bob. How did you find this tool from a usefulness standpoint? I mean, it was fairly easy to do once we had it, but that is very secondary to how useful it was in you looking at your goals in the context of the, you know, of the form. I mean, if it wasn't useful, then we blow it up and start over again. I mean, it shouldn't. My opinion is that there shouldn't be just an exercise in completing a form.
Well, let me answer that by telling you how I review people. They have goals. We sit down, hopefully more than once a year, and talk about the goals. It's rare, but sometimes someone achieves every single goal completely. That's pretty rare, but it does occasionally happen. But
then you have to promote them, right?
Yeah. To ask them other questions, how you doing it? I'd like to do that. And then there's sometimes when some people complete less than half of their goals. That doesn't mean they had a bad year. Other things happened that were much more important during the year. So I think your approach is good and very helpful. The reason I think you need more is because you can't measure any person by something you decided on one day in October as goals, because unexpected things happened since October. Evaluating on goals is probably the single most important tool there is, as I like measuring the output, not just the effort.
Right.
But I think you got to do a little more than that to have some measure of other things, whatever they are.
What does more mean? What is
like management style? Yeah. How did you handle things that weren't listed as goals that came along? You know, I don't have a good list developed, but you can't measure someone by just the, in most staff's goals, they get 5 to 6 to 7, maybe with some pieces. And it could be that the goals are all things that are not currently done by the organization, let's say. Yeah. But their real job is to do their job.
Yeah.
And that comes first.
And shouldn't part of that also be, you know, how well you put them in a position to do their job well or not?
Absolutely. So the goals are really important, but if you look at your goals, by and large, there are things that are new or different or not being done. What about all the other things the organization does? Somehow, someone needs to be accountable for that, and in that case, it's me. So if things aren't goals, you know, you should absolutely feel free to have comments on them. Pick any department, pick any function, however you want to format it. There has to be some evaluation of the run-of-the-mill, if you will, operation of the town. And part of that's management, part of that is other things.
It's a little different, though. I remember last year, Bob, when we designed this, this was really aimed at the vital few objectives that were above the standard knitting to get the job done. It wasn't the day-to-day stuff. It wasn't the management style. It was the stretch objectives that probably wouldn't all be met, certainly not in a year, but you wanted to show progress. If you're describing now you'd rather at least have some elements of the day-to-day stuff.
Well,
there's a way to
I would like feedback if you're not happy, certainly.
Yeah.
Whether
you get
choose...
That, do you feel like you get that from us now?
I don't get a lot of complaints.
Well, so I mean that, yeah, but that's a different question. I mean, there's, you know, there's feedback, and you know,
yeah.
There, I mean, there's
I do get it.
A complaint. I mean, you know, I think my personal experience, you know, with you, when I think about, you know, you being the town manager, is that you create an inviting style for suggestion and for how is this going, you know, kind of thing from us. I personally try to take advantage of that whenever I can, and you know, you probably get tired of me talking to you and calling you about it, but
not yet.
And I'm sure you'll tell me because you're pretty straightforward about those things. These kinds of forms can be dangerous.
I agree, and I will say this board specifically is very honest and straightforward and open, and I've always found that to be true. Do you have a responsibility to other people not in this room to do more of an evaluation? I might be satisfied. What does the community think? I don't know.
Yeah.
What does the rest of the organization think? I don't know.
Well, like we have to answer to the community, and you're right about that. Mm-hmm. And so we need some format that someone could what are you doing? What are you
goals
doing?
Goals are a really important part of anyone's job, but they're not the whole job. And you know, Dr. Doherty's evaluation has both. Mm-hmm. How are you doing? How are you doing at this? How are you doing at that? How are you doing at this task?
But how are you doing and how are you doing it?
Yeah.
Are kind of two different questions.
Kind of. So I'm not dying to create a lot of work for you by any means. But if you can come up with a simple metric that you think would be helpful, and I'll be happy to work with whichever two of you want to do it. I can look at other towns, see how they do it. It's not always just goal-based, though. I do know that.
How did we evaluate the former manager?
You know, I was looking at that. Let me just see if I printed it out. It was largely goals. But yeah, I did have one. I completely picked this at random. I don't have it electronically. This is calendar year 2010. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There were 6 categories. Each selectman picked a scale from 1 to 5 in 6 categories. Development, personnel, finance, operations, services, and policies and procedures. So, you know, that's the sum total. So there was no evaluation of goals specifically other than how they related to the 6 functional areas.
Where's the feedback on that?
And then there was room for comment. So, you know, a given selectman, whoever this was, says James Bonazzoli, wrote bullet points under development of feedback and gave Pete a numerical score. It's just a different approach. I don't know. I never really asked Pete if he found this helpful, but I know he cared.
Did we ask you to do a self-evaluation on the goals? I think you did in some form. I don't have it.
I have one tonight. I have an update. I don't know if it's really a self-evaluation.
On this year's, yeah.
I have an update for it. I'm happy to
actually
fill in and write things on them, which I haven't done here tonight.
What's the timeline for this?
It's up to you.
Do we have a kind of a standard?
It's based on the fiscal year.
It's a fiscal year, so which is concluding.
You know, ideally, the evaluation and the goals don't have to be at the same time. The goals should be done in a perfect world by May.
Yeah.
Because I need to pass them down to the organization. Instead, I've already reviewed everyone I review, and so they've all reviewed all the people they review for June 30th deadlines, And, you know, we have a lot of goals, and believe me, there's plenty of work from last year not done, and there's lots of new things suggested. Sure. But I don't think any of them raise to your level. It's really tasks and operational. But for department heads, it would work better, again, if we had goals that we all agreed on for the department heads before their evaluations were done. Mm-hmm. I have to say it's not a problem, but that would be an ideal world. Is it ever going to happen? I don't know, because town meeting is in May. You know, it's always going to be rushed. But if the board, you don't want to be goals driven and just list, look at a piece of paper and drop everything else you're doing. Yeah. It's not like the goals that you've given me are only addressed when we talk about goals. We talk about it all the time, just individually, individual items. So the goals discussion ideally is a little sooner. The evaluation of the town manager is supposed to be at the end of the fiscal year. So in theory, that means after June 30. So at your July meeting is perfect. August is fine. October is probably too late.
Yes, sure. I actually think this gets a lot easier when Reading 2020 is done.
I think
if we can get some serious work done on that strategic plan, this will flow out of that in a kind of a cogent way. There'll be a natural flow of how are we doing and how are we doing it. Those are the kind of those are two things. I don't know I forget how many things run this form. Does anybody remember?
It was upwards of 30.
Seemed like 30 or 40.
It was 36 actual goals.
How many?
36 goals.
I don't know.
On 2020 or on this last?
That's goals, and then some of them were 2020. 2020 had some things that weren't technically goals.
2020 is almost here.
Yeah, it is.
That's
maybe 2 minutes.
I spent a whole business life reviewing my personal goals the first of every month. And, somebody taught me a long time ago, this is the right amount, and you can manage this many. It gets bigger than that. Why are you bothering? Because you can't even remember what the hell you're supposed to be doing each day. I think that...
Guilty.
Yeah. No, I honestly think that when you have 36 goals, how can you...
They have to roll up to...
You pick three a month? How do you do that? I just think that...
Bear in mind, I'm not doing all the work.
No, I understand that. I get that you're supervising a lot of the work, but when we decide to have a discussion with you about evaluating, our job is to evaluate you as the town manager. Your job is to evaluate all of those people and how they play into this stuff. Theoretically, in my mind, one of the things, for example, I'd want to know from the town manager if I was designing this form is, tell me what's going on. Tell me how you manage your people. Or set a goal around that. What do you look? So you see what I'm getting at is, if we get too deep in the weeds here,
you won't get anywhere.
We kind of get nothing done.
If I might suggest for this year, do the goals. There's 36 of them.
Yep.
You can all decide, what your opinions are. And just create some kind of free format where you can feel free to comment on something that's not a goal. And give me whatever feedback you like. And if you want to organize that in more than one area, I don't care. But please feel free to comment on anything you think is important as the job of town manager.
I'd love to know from you, and I think this is, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot, I think this is something you need to reflect on.
Yeah, I think I
would. How is it what are the things you'd like us to... look in on and help you help you manage those. Not that we want to go do your work, because that's not our job. But it is our job to evaluate how you're doing your job, and actually nobody knows the job better than you do. So
there's one guy in town that does.
I'm not sure of that.
He's probably not watching right now.
Looking at some of these things, and these are very sort of goal and objective driven. But one of the things on here that's I think really key that I don't think is on here is just sort of style issues, communication
issues. Right, that's what we're going to have.
And, you know.
Again, the origin of this was, think about the few things that we needed to grow. So it was very much, not the 36 is a few, but it was the things that are different and new and additive, not the things that are the same and consistent every year. So it wasn't style issues. That may have been a deficit, but it was designed to have only the new, not the style issues. I agree with you. It's an oversight.
You know, I think part of this, too, last year, where obviously I was under time constraints, a lot of the trouble I had with really doing a good evaluation for you is I really needed to speak with a lot of different people to do it.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of categories in here where I am not even close to up to par with what department heads are and how they deal with you on a regular basis.
Records management.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of even things as simple as, you know, public safety. So there was a lot of phone calls that I just didn't have the time to make, you know, around my son being born, that I wanted to make to really give you a better evaluation. I think that was certainly part of it, from my aspect anyways.
You know, and you guys can feel free to reach out to the school committee. I don't know how they do the superintendent's evaluation. It's pretty intense, pretty complex and detail-oriented. I don't know how they go about gaining their information. Is it just from observing John at meetings and public events and so forth that they ask other people?
School stuff tends to be very data-driven.
And his evaluation is intensely data.
Yeah.
It's a difficult thing. My feeling is you really to get a really great evaluation for you, you really got to get some feedback.
Yeah.
Good, bad, and indifferent.
Right.
The best place to get that is the people that you oversee.
Absolutely.
The problem with getting it from the people you oversee.
I'll never say.
It better be anonymous.
It has to be anonymous, yeah. So it is a difficult thing, I think, to get you the right feedback, especially over this stretch of a number of categories.
But there's things that the board can observe.
Absolutely.
Right. And you don't necessarily need the detailed information.
Right.
I mean, I don't know, just to start picking off some areas. How well do you interact with, you can make a whole long list of boards and committees, taxpayers, businesses, mm-hmm. residents, other communities, RMLD, school department, whatever, you know, whatever's on that list. But I don't want to, by any means, cause a lot of work that has no value to any of us.
Especially you.
Well, so that's why I think maybe this year the free format would be fine, yeah. And see what happens. See what you all think is important to tell me. Hmm. And then if you find some commonality, maybe you'll say, you know, we could group this a little differently for the future.
Hmm. I mean, would something be, you know, as simple as quarterly evals rather than yearly ones? Would that be helpful, more detrimental?
Well, we do I think it's three times a year, whatever that's called, goals update.
Yeah.
But the board should absolutely feel free to evaluate me anytime you want. Anytime is helpful. You know what your agendas are like, but... And it can be done informally. One or two of you can sit down with me. Being careful of open meeting law, I just want it to be your opinions, but...
Right.
You know, that's the chair and the vice chair normally have some role in that.
Okay, so proceeding forward, who would like to volunteer to be on the subcommittee? Come on.
I would.
All right. Barry and I will work it. I think we're going to take the position that we want to try to wrap this up in August.
Okay. That'd be fine.
That should be enough time. All right, we'll get together. Awesome.
And if you folks want to reach out to department heads for any information, please feel free to do that.
Okay.
You don't have to tell me.
We will. All righty. I think we're left with minutes, and the executive session one can be done. Yes?
I do have, I don't know if you want it, but I do have an update on page 62 and 3 on goals. There's not really anything we have to go over,
that.
But just to make sure you
very
all
end.
See it.
On the packet?
Yes,
yeah.
In tonight's
very
packet.
Very end of the packet. That's
and the things that
goals.
Are boxed with an X are things that have changed since February in the positive direction. And I guess I'll just ask a couple questions of the board. Review Board of Selectmen policies, you've said, is not a high priority, and I would agree. Review other town bylaws, conservation, that's still hanging out there as I don't know what the board wishes to do. FinCom review on procurement has obviously caused us to stop there.
Yep.
I think those are the only questions I had. I will say that We had a meeting with a developer recently that has caused us to think the downtown parking needs to come to the front burner from the back burner, because there's a couple of projects in downtown that might start hopping. It's actually two.
I'm trying to.
So that'll be a change, and then.
So those things that are boxed on here are the ones that you feel have changed?
Those are the ones that, since I last handed you out this update, have progressed further
left.
Up the
yep.
chain to be completed.
In all cases, to the better.
Yes, in all cases, to the better. So, for instance, you know, the first two under administration are now complete. I don't know what they were in February, but they weren't complete.
And those were driving goals.
Yep. Yeah. So to evaluate more formally, I'm happy to take this two-pager and actually give you some flesh behind it, and give you some text and some background.
Sure.
And I'll ask department heads and others to help.
Very good.
This is helpful
yep.
to me. It creates, creates talking points.
When was this done?
The goals were, formalized in October.
Right. right.
And
okay.
then the board has, I think this is the third update, probably one in the fall, late fall, one
yep.
in February, and then this would be the third one,
mm-hmm.
which we can do more often if you choose. I think the comment is right that we need to meet on a Saturday and do 2020, and that's going to help us
we
all.
We should probably pick a couple of dates before another
yeah.
half a year goes by.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yep, I agree with that.
Okay, anything more on this topic at this time? We have some work to do. All right, we have minutes. And Bob, we can do the executive minutes in open as long as we don't change them, right?
Correct.
Correct.
Okay, Kevin.
Move to approve the Board of Selectmen minutes of May 19th, 2015 as amended.
That's seconded.
Second?
Second. Discussion? Corrections? All in favor?
So it was 8-4 May.
5-0. May
19th.
Yeah.
Next. I got to get it first. Yeah. Move to approve the Board of Selectmen's minutes of June 2nd, 2015, as amended.
That's second?
Second.
Okay. That was a regular meeting. Right. Yes.
That was our last meeting.
June 3rd was a financial forum?
Correct.
Yeah, June 3rd was the MAPC thing.
Yes. Oh, okay, got it, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, on the June 2nd minutes discussion.
Was it second?
I second.
John A.
Oh, I will be needing to abstain. I wasn't
okay.
present.
All in favor? Opposed, abstaining, 4-0-1.
Move to approve the Board of Selectmen minutes of June 3rd, 2015 as amended.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
I'll be abstaining.
Okay. 3.
I'm abstaining.
0-2. And executive session.
Yeah. Not much to abstain, but.
No.
Move to approve the Board of Selectmen executive session minutes of June 2nd, 2015 as written.
Well, second.
Second.
John Arena seconds. Poll the board. This is a roll call. John?
Yes.
John?
Abstain.
I say yes.
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 Okay. The vote is 4-0-1. Is there any other business that should come before the board this evening? If not, I will.
Motion to adjourn.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Everybody in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned.